It was an uphill climb last week for Delaware as the Blue Hens battle back from 21 down to win and advance in the opening round of the FCS playoffs. Tonight, they continue their uphill climb, literally some 3,200 feet up the mountain as Montana enters the playoff fray for the first time, confidently knowing that the road to Frisco rolls through Missoula for the next 3 weeks. 2,300 miles from home, the first state collides with the Treasure State next. The first weekend of December brings playoff football back to Missoula as we welcome you to the coverage of the second round of the FCS playoffs. A good one at the base of Mount Sentinel tonight. 9-3 Delaware out of the Coastal Athletic travels all the way across the country to take a shot at the Big Sky champions from Montana. We started the day with 16 teams. This is the updated bracket. Furman has advanced. They await the winner of this one. It's an all-Missouri Valley Football Conference showdown on the bottom half as North Dakota State and South Dakota collide. And a pleasant good evening, Sean Kenny, alongside Michigan national champion Marcus Ray. So great to have you with us. I'll tell you what, Marcus, for two Blue Bloods, it is the final meeting between these two powers at the FCS level after the news broke earlier this week that Delaware will move to FBS. They will join Conference USA beginning in the fall of 2025.
That's a great opportunity for Delaware, but tonight, there's no better atmosphere for college football in the truest playoff setting there is.
Two great defenses will be on full display tonight. Let's start with Montana. Nobody has been more dominant over the past month than the Grizz, headlined by Braxton Hill.
Braxton Hill is productive, disruptive, the first team all Big Sky linebacker. He's very good in space, as you see the pick six right there. He's very instinctive too. He runs to the football, tips and overthrows is what he likes to do. He's a very productive linebacker. Look for him to make some plays in the middle. But on the flip side, you got Jackson Taylor. This man is instinctive, 100 plus tackles on the season. He is the key cog to that defense. Look for him to make some plays and trying to stop that run in that Montana offense that you see another turnover right there. He's just as disruptive.
There aren't too many places noisier than where we're at tonight, especially when they turn the lights on inside Washington-Grizzly Stadium. 10th loudest stadium in all of college football. Young Will Thomas catering the big letter G tonight. Loving the weather. The journalism student celebrating his 21st birthday tonight. No better place than here in Missoula. And wouldn't you know, the sky just opened up as we get ready for kickoff. Snow showers throughout the next couple of hours. The wind will be a factor. Gust as high as 40 miles per hour here tonight. Delaware won the toss. They elected to defer, so we will watch this Montana offense. Second round FCS, the winner to get Furman next weekend in the quarterfinals. Nate Reed with the approach, and we are underway tonight. A snowy night from Missoula. The dangerous Junior Bergen on the return, out past the 25, up to the 27-yard line, and that's where this Montana offense will go to work. Clifton McDowell, 8-0 this year as a starter, 7 straight wins after really taking the reins of this offense full-time against Idaho State, a dual-threat quarterback that has just made this offense really tough to stop.
Yeah, he's very accurate, so you see the touchdown to interception ratio. He can do it with his legs. Big Sky newcomer of the year. See if he can get it done in this inclement weather.
Bergen in motion. He will whip it out. Quick throw, making the catch, and a quick move by Aaron Fonts and good yardage. 11 yards on the first down strike to Fonts, escorted out of bounds by Ty Davis.
That's the way you want to start the game, with a quick screen. We call that a smoke screen. If you want that one-on-one matchup, that'll definitely help your completion percentage and then yards after the catch if you can make those plays.
We're going to say Fon stepped out at the 36, so second and a yard. Again, a little wobbler and a knuckleball, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Tyron Herring, and Delaware comes away with the game's first turnover for Herring, his third interception of the year.
That right there, Sean, is an RPO gone wrong. Run pass option. McDowell had the option to hand it off to his running back. As he reads the linebacker, though, he overshoots his receivers. Looked like Fontes also could have been safer, could have been the target, but that was hard to see right there. That is called a stick route off the RPO.
This has been a very opportunistic defense throughout the year for Delaware, their 23rd takeaway, and now on first down, confusion for the Blue Hens. It is a Missouri Valley Football Conference officiating crew. A lot of question marks coming into tonight. Who would get the nod under center? And for Delaware, Ryan O'Connor, healthy enough to give it a shot tonight. First-year starter, he has started 9 of 12 games. Did not play last week in the home win against Lafayette. After the penalty, he's going to come out throwing, hit as he fires toward the sideline, and it's incomplete, looking for Joshua Youngblood.
Youngblood came up big last week in the come-from-behind win. It'll be tough, I think, to throw the ball in this snow flurry here. These teams are going to have to establish the run, but with this field position, I think Delaware can throw some quick game passes. You just don't want to turn it over, and you want to get some points off the turnover.
Tough night to audible. O'Connor will hand it off straight up the middle. This is Marcus Yarn. So, Marcus, the two question marks for Delaware, both out there. A promising note for the Blue Hens.
Question mark if he was going to run the football this week. I tell you what, I like the call there, and I like the adjustment of bringing in the receivers into a tight set. As you see Yarn's numbers on the season, it's a big-time running back, 871 yards on the season. 18 touchdowns, buddy.
Yarns was injured late in the game last week. He was a question mark coming in, along with a handful of other Blue Hens, but their starting quarterback and their explosive tailback in there for this big one. Swing it out to Youngblood and the speed of this Montana defense. Nash Fouch, Levi Giannacaro pursuing.
Fouch coming down from his free safety position. He plays near the box, though. See, the Blue Hens tried to get that quick screen out of there. I like the call. It just didn't work. But I like the call. And also, they're playing a field position game here. When you're on the road, one thing you want to try to do is take the crowd out of the game. That hasn't worked yet because the defense has responded. This crowd is rowdy. But if you're Montana, great stop.
Ryan Cost will send an end-over-end punt that bounces inside the five and through the end zone for the touchback. So the Blue Hens miss a scoring opportunity after the interception by Herring. Fans here in Missoula having a blast. The offense back out onto the field for the second time in the heavy snow here in the mountains. Bobby Houck has certainly seen his share of snow games throughout the years here in Missoula. Normally, he comes out on top. Second time that he is a finalist for the prestigious Eddie Robinson Award, the Big Sky Coach of the Year. For the fourth time in 12 years, he passed some Grizz greats, Don Reed, Joe Glenn, each of those coaches winning three of them. Now Houck behind this strong season, a Big Sky championship for the Grizz. As he gets ready to watch his offense go to work. Possession number two for Clifton McDowell after he was picked off by Herring. On first down from the 20, and they will give it to the talented freshman. This is Eli Gilman, yards after contact, as Gilman barrels his way up to the 29.
I like to call there on first down by Montana. Watch the misdirection with the jet sweep. That'll take linebackers and open up run lanes right there for Gilman. I think if they do more of that, that'll keep the defense on their heels and guessing as well.
What a year it's been for the redshirt freshman out of Minnesota on the Jerry Rice watch list, top national freshman in the FCS. Penetration that time shooting through was Jackson Taylor. He's the featured defender for this Delaware team who's just had a fantastic year coming over from Division II Westchester.
And that's why he was an All-American at the D2 level, all-conference. linebacker, as you see Gilman's numbers this season, 10 touchdowns. Numbers speak for themselves. Most among FCS freshmen. Very talented young man.
Third down, a long yard. Under center, and they will play power football behind this very aggressive offensive line. Taylor ends up with the football, but they're going to say forward progress. It stopped, and the Grizz moved the chains of first down.
Look at the double team right there at the point of attack. Eshawn Hunter, 55, very tough defensive lineman at the nose guard position. If they're going to run the football, they have to neutralize him. Great job there by Forbes and Brown on that offensive line.
Keyshawn Hunter, a junior, a real fun one to watch. First year coming over from Old Dominion. Nick Osmo with his first touch, stretching the field as wide as he possibly could. KT Say, the freshman from Norfolk, in on the stop.
That play is called a wide zone, and it's interesting to see how they blocked it because Delaware lined up extremely wide. As you see, Osmo, 511 yards, Sean. They got guys putting up numbers, man.
So many of these Montana players, a veteran, he has been around this program a while. He announced this past offseason that this will be his final year, even though he has a season of eligibility. Trying to go out with a bang, second down and short. McDowell waits and throws, and it's knocked away, incomplete. Good job by Khalil Dawsey.
Dawsey getting up, celebrating. Watch his footwork there. That's excellent technique, even with a club on his hand. That's how you play the football. He maintained his inside leverage. Broke their reception point. Great pass breakup for that young man.
Delaware hit the transfer portal hard this offseason in the secondary. Herring, Lyde, and Dawsey, all three transfers, all three first-year players for the Blue Hens, and defensive coordinator Manny Rojas. Third down, they bring a blitz, it's picked up, and the pass is caught, and a first down at the 46-yard line. That's Keelan White.
If you're going to play off coverage on third down like that, what I mean by off is soft, where the cornerbacks are 7 to 8 yards off. Montana's going to take that every time. I was expecting them to play a little bit more man like they did on the previous play with Khalil Dawsey getting that breakup. You want to take away those easy routes and make these receivers earn it.
White so reliable. He's now caught a pass in every single game this year. 39 receptions on the season. They fake the jet sweep. Big hole opens up over the left side for Osmo as he falls onto the plus side. Ty Davis from the secondary able to trip him up.
Osmo also catch that football well out the backfield. Once again, you get the jet sweep with the down block and the kick out. Leaves a big run lane right there. Good downhill run, excellent blocking. As you see, that's the second time they ran that play on first down.
It's a pretty powerful 1-2 punch when you factor in both Gilman and Osmo. Second and short, McDowell is going to keep it, and he gets to the corner. A flag flies as McDowell is shoved out of bounds by Herring, and a flag thrown in the vicinity of a hole.
I like the ball.
Offense, number 18-4. 10-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
That's the tight end, Evan Schaefer.
I like that call on second and short because you put three receivers to one side. The defense has to plus over and honor that. The quarterback run to the weak side. You just have to maintain.
Second and 13 after the
it's penalty. A tough block, though, Sean, because when the quarterback keeps it, Schaefer has to slide and get his arms on the outside part of the defender. It's easy to grab cloth that way.
Inner wonderland already here in this first quarter. Snow continues to fall. They will pitch it to the right side. This is Xavier Harris, and Harris able to get a good surge outside that right tackle. Taylor in on the stop. Harris back to the 48, setting up a third down.
Right there you see Grizz running that toss sweep, a delayed toss sweep when you saw McDowell kind of shuffle. He's trying to freeze those linebackers because he could fake that pitch and keep it. So they block that play the same way. It's tough for a defense to respond.
Montana continues to keep fresh backs. They just rotate Gilman, Osmo, Harris. McDowell on the out pattern, caught, reeled in by White, and another third down conversion.
8 yard gain, good for another.
Gain of eight, up to the 40.
You'll see right here, just a simple 5 yard out. Third down, Keelan White understood exactly what his sticks were, but more impressively was the throw by Clifton McDowell. He's proven to me he understands coverage. And what I mean by coverage, he knows where the defense is supposed to be when they drop back.
All 3 of 5 throwing. He will test the waters inside, zigzagging his way up to the 37-yard line. Marcus, you've played in the elements many a days back in Ann Arbor. What's it like? What's the adjustment defensively playing in the snow and a wet track like tonight?
Well, the biggest thing is trying to maintain your footwork, especially for a defensive back, just being able to plant and cut, but then also tackling. You know, I've seen a few missed tackles already. You really have to make body contact. Those arm tackles aren't going to work in the snow.
Ball put on the turf. It bounces right back into Gilman's lap, and then Delaware swallows him up. Mateo Vandamia making sure Gilman wasn't going anywhere.
Well, that play didn't have the best of timing there. It looked like McDowell kind of slammed the football in there, too, as you see that jet sweep hit a little bit too quickly. Threw off the timing with the handoff.
12th play of this drive. Quick moving first quarter, inside 7 minutes to go. Two receivers right again. The Blue Hens bring a blitz. Gilman picks it up. Out pattern just beyond the outstretched arms of Funtz. Good coverage by Herring, and now an early decision for Bobby Hout.
First of all, this is great pass protection there, but watch the footwork technique there by Herring, getting a break. But I think that time it was hard for Funtz to get out of that. That was a comeback run. Couldn't quite get that left foot planted in the ground firm.
Houck is going to keep the offense out there. Does not want to play a field position game early. Fourth down and 8. They need to get it to the Delaware 30. 7 up on the line of scrimmage for the Blue Hens. Let's see if they come. They rush 6. McDowell hit as he throws. Out there, Bergen, and it's knocked away by Hassan Manning. But here comes a late flag. And Manning can't believe it.
That's a tough break there. Straight zero cover. Zero means no help. But blitz 6, spied with the linebacker. Everyone was in man coverage. Now let's take a look here. Good protection. Now, when you're playing zero coverage, that ball is either have to come out quick or it's going to be a deep ball. I think if he would have turned around a little bit sooner and played the ball, I don't really know if that's interference, but he just quite didn't play the ball. He played the hands on. You can face guard in college. You just can't make contact.
Ryan Carty is hot. He is still letting this crew have it along the Delaware sideline. Drive kept alive and big hit by Jackson Taylor. So he is making an impact right out of the gate here, and you see why these coaches were just raving about what he brings to the table each and every day.
Yeah, they say practice violently. He has one speed. First team all-conference, 100-plus tackles. Man is very productive and disruptive, as you see. 6'1", 239 pounds. And he can run, too. Sideline to sideline, and he covers well in space.
36th player in Delaware history to have 100 tackles in a season. And there is Mr. Hunter and Jack Hall. They met Gilman 2 yards deep in the backfield.
They're starting to sniff that out a little bit. The jet sweep with the handoff up the middle. Look at the Delaware defense so far this season. Look at the number of turnovers forced. 24 tackles for losses. Scoring defense just under 22. Very, very good defensive ball game.
And that might go under the radar a little bit. You think Delaware and their history, the great quarterback play, but their defense has been really stout the last couple of years. Manny Rojas with a lot of new faces this season. Third down and 12. They'll take a shot toward the end zone. Bergen was out there, but McDowell a little too tall on the release.
It's a nice job of Bergen, man, running that post route. Montana was expecting pressure there on third down, as you see. little bit of penetration up the middle. It's a throw he wanted to come back. I guarantee you, if it wasn't in the snow, he brings that one down. That's a touchdown.
Nick Ramos out to attempt the kick. This will be a 43-yard field goal. Ramos back in the starting lineup here over the last few games. He's made five consecutive field goals. Travis Benham with the placement. Tough elements tonight. Kick on the way. And it is good for Ramos. Play drive for the Grizz ends up with three. Who needs a stinking guitar in the snow? Certainly. It is a long story tradition when you look at Delaware football and the run of success that they have had. Six football national championships throughout the proud heritage of the Fightin' Blue Hens, Division II champions 1946, again in 63, and then they had that run in the 70s. Oh, Blue Hen fans remember so well. Back-to-back titles, 71-72. 1979, they captured it. And then moving up to the FCS ranks, you go back to 2003. B.C. Keeler and the Delaware Blue Hens and Ryan Carty in year number two. He knows what it's all about. He was the backup quarterback back in his days for the Blue Hens. Exceptional coach, has just brought a lot of energy and passion back to his alma mater. And now the excitement of transition, Marcus, as they get ready to make the move to FBS in 2025, start a play in Conference USA.
And all those national championships allow them to wear those winged helmets, as you know, I wore that same one down the road here a couple thousand miles away.
Having trouble with the kick, recovering nicely and taking it out past the 20. Carty told us that although the news is exciting, it came at a tough time as far as trying to keep his players on track with the game at hand and the excitement of the unknown as far as plowing into the FBS in Conference USA.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of benefits there. You get the national exposure, there's fundraisings, and it's good for the university. You get more scholarships as well, but you got some of those guys that won't be able to play in the postseason next year. I mean, this is it for some of these guys.
Their final go around in the FCS as they try to stretch it, looking for a cutback lane, and there is nothing there whatsoever. A loss of yard on the play as Hayden Harris brings him down. So you look at what's in store moving forward for Delaware as they make this transition. Ryan Carty, next year will be their final year at the FCS, but they are not eligible for the playoffs. And then they move into the fall of 25. They'll be eligible for the regular season title in Conference USA. And then they are a full-pledged FBS Conference USA member in 2026.
And they're also going to play in the postseason in a bowl game as well in 26.
Loss of two. Second down throw. Pass is caught, but a minimal gain. Back close to the original line of scrimmage. Braxton Hill, who leads this team in tackles, in on the stop.
It's a nice job of Hill getting off a block, playing in space. He plays that outside linebacker at overhang position. He's a blitzer. But he's tough to block for some of these wide receivers.
Hill comes on a blitz. O'Connor moving the pocket. Has time, still waiting. Now floats deep downfield. Incomplete. Good coverage by the Montana secondary. And Delaware with a quick three and out.
I tell you, Montana was expecting rollout pass. As you see, the defense just spot dropping. Anytime you see four receivers to one side, we call that four strong. Either the quarterback's going to roll to that side and they know exactly where the routes are going to be. Otherwise, you have to work backside where it's one-on-one. That's good coverage there.
Junior Bergen awaiting the punt from Ryan Cost. Here come the Grizz, and they got a piece of it. The punt is blocked as it ricochets out of bounds.
Good
Vincent Genitone with the block.
Starts with the high snap, which throws off the timing. Oh, great effort. Way to lay out and get a piece.
Sawyer Renicali got a piece of it. All smiles for Hauk and the Grizz. You get to these championship special teams, always a key factor, and it is the Grizz coming up. The high snap. Cost has his punt blocked. Great job by Sawyer Racanelli coming through, getting a piece of it. Officials wanting a timeout so they could bring in the shovels for traction as they continue to fight the snow. Monty says, let's do some snow angels. That's his form of shoveling.
Yeah, well, they had to clear the field so that they could get the hash mark, so they could spot the football. That's the one reason you saw them shoveling straight down the field. As you see those lines in the middle of your screen, you have to spot the ball on those hash marks.
Good starting position for the Grizz, and for the first time, they will go with the jet sweep. Getting outside, Harris has the corner, tight ropes the sideline, makes a spin. Did he stay in bounds? Yes, he did. Touchdown. 27 yards. Xavier Harris, there is a flag down.
Offside defense.
The touchdown for the three-year vet stands.
Xavier Harris normally lines up at running back, but you see here, that's another way to get him in space. Line him up in the slot. That's just a long handoff, a toss sweep. Remember I said tackling. I don't know if that was due to the snow, but you definitely have to wrap up. You can't go up and body block him. He's too good in space right there. Some missed tackle. You're not going to bring that young man down as he scores his first touchdown of the season on that play.
Harris did not have a carry a couple of weeks ago in the regular season finale against Montana State. He led this team in rushing a couple of years ago, but with the addition of Gilman, the way Osmo has been running, just simply not enough footballs to go around, but you always have to be ready. And Xavier Harris delivers the touchdown run, 27 yards, and the Grizz up 10-0. And look at Bobby Hauk and the success that he has had with Montana throughout the years. His second tenure, keep in mind, his first go-around, he won seven consecutive Big Sky Championships, and we were inside his office earlier this week. You see the rings. It's always interesting to see what these coaches like to read. Patton was a big guy, the Battle of the Bulge. See Eddie Robinson, part of the collection, and then the historic game ball, which was presented to him as he became Montana's winningest head coach. This weather tonight, similar to what they experience in the historic Battle of the Bulge. Snowy conditions here in Missoula.
There's no other way, man. It has to be like this. But Coach Hauk, though, man, very accomplished, very humble. What he's done with this program is amazing.
So for the second straight week, Delaware falls behind. 10-0 here on the road, and now a very important series for the Blue Hens. Take a look at what Montana has been able to do ever since they lost to Northern Arizona back in late September. They have had to win out to capture the Big Sky Championship, and that's exactly what they have done, and they have done it in dominating fashion over the last four games. 24 points. Yeah, grand total of 24 allowed through the last 4 weeks. And here comes the crowd inside Grizzly Stadium. Down run, nets four, up to the 29.
That's one way to get that offense going, though, Sean, is you have to run the football. I mean, I don't think throwing the ball against the defense this good is going to be the plan. That you look at the play selection there, Montana. Obviously, they've doubled up on their play total and some, but they're running the football first.
Delaware still searching for their first down in this opening quarter. A little misdirection play, and a hole opens up, and there goes Quincy Watson in a first down run into the secondary. Ryder Meyer drives him out of bounds, and not before Watson picks up the first down for the Blue Hens.
Well-designed play. That's called a sprint draw, and they executed that perfectly. As you see, Watson getting in space, turning that sideline, man. They're trying to create one-on-one matchups, and they're blocking that pretty well. I think Delaware has to keep running the ball. You see Coach Carty fired up about that.
24-yard run by Watson, one of the heroes with all the injuries last week, both he and Jonathan Silver. Play clock down to five. They will hand it off straight up the middle with Yarns. Keeps his balance, pulls forward for a yard or two. Ryan Tyrrell and Hayden Harris in on the stop. Running right around the hash marks, and that's where the shoveling took place on that last timeout. Second time tonight, Delaware has been on the Montana side. Could not capitalize following the interception back on the first possession, and now they have moved it to the Grizz 47. Second and nine. O'Connor throws low, and let's see. I'm going to say a catch. Short gain at the 44. Good job there by Joshua Youngblood to get his hands underneath it.
That was an RPO, too. He could have easily handed that football off, but he liked the cushion he's seen on the outside by the defense, and that's why he threw that ball to Youngblood.
Delaware trying to get everybody lined up so they don't take another look at it. You heard the crowd get a view of it up on the Jumbotron, and the Blue Hens could not get a playoff. And now they are going to say incomplete, as they're going to take another look at it, so will we.
It wasn't the greatest thrown ball. It was a skip right there. Skipped right into his arms. Felt about it half a yard short. Well, from that angle, it looked like he caught it, but the side view, the one hopper.
Quick reversal on the look upstairs, and a third down for this Delaware offense. An eye on number 17, Jordan Townsend, at the top of the screen. He's the inside slot. They keep it on the ground, and a hole opens up. Quick burst by Marcus Yarns. Situation there, Marcus, where Ryan Carty knew he had two plays to try to get the necessary yardage.
Yeah, they checked to the sideline there, and they got the matchup. They want it to the weak side in the run game. I like the call there. This Montana defense lined up in one thing and run opposite. It's awfully loud in here, Sean.
Fourth and two. O'Connor on the back pedal floats into triple coverage, incomplete, looking for the tight end, Bros. And Montana comes up with the fourth down stop.
Interesting call there. You see at the top of your screen right there, got away with a nice little hold there. But if he didn't call it, they didn't do it. And I tell you, the former defensive back, you never get away with that one. But and there was no reason really for Walker to hold. He had good coverage right there. But I would have liked to see Delaware run the ball again. I would have liked to see them spread them out and run the same play they ran before the yards.
Montana goes back to work. Fonts in motion. McDowell wanted to go deep. Now fires, and it's caught. Bergen with the catch. Twisted ahead by Herring. Stays on his feet. Never went down. Herring threw him forward, and then Dylan Traynor finished it. But Junior Bergen, with the athleticism that he has showcased throughout his entire time here at Montana.
That was a good completion right there. A lot of patience. He had time to throw that football, too. Bergen found that space, so they're going to take a look at that spot, see if he was down or not. But I tell you what, just by design, that route combination was pretty good.
So Montana entering tonight, one of the best defenses in all of college football, and they have not disappointed despite the early turnover. The snow falling in Missoula. Harris with the long touchdown run. Grizz by 10 after one. Montana winning all three facets of this one, and it started with special teams. The block punt, Marcus, set the tone for the Grizz.
Sawyer Racanelli making a big play. Montana came out slow with the turnover, and then they figured out a way to get Xavier Harris the football in space. He tap dances and give a little spinneroo on the sideline for their only touchdown, but Montana's been in control. Six first downs in that first quarter, as you see the total yards being tripled.
They are going to say Bergen's knee was down back at the 35. Really won't matter here as Osmo's in the clear. A foot race to the pylon. Touchdown, Nick Osmo.
You'll see right here, just an inside zone one play that they blocked extremely well. It's going for two.
Trying to hit the two-point conversion, and this play going absolutely nowhere. That was Meyer, their starting strong safety, taking that snap for the two-point conversion. Osmo, the touchdown run. He now has five rushing touchdowns over his last four games. And Marcus, what is Montana doing on these last couple of drives to make it look pretty easy offensively?
What they're doing is they're blocking at the point of attack, that three-man front. Then, see, a three-man front allows you to get two more linemen up to the linebacker. So if their linemen are getting second level, then their running backs, once they get to the second level, they're not even getting touched. As you see his numbers with the long of 35 yards, three rushes, 46 yards. Look how explosive and fast Otsmith was on that last run. But they're just getting the ball to the second level untouched.
Trouble really brewing here on the road for Delaware. Fell behind last week to Lafayette, 28-7 in the first half, and now 16-0. Townsend on the return. Let's go back to the touchdown run, Marcus, for Osma.
You'll see here. Watch the left side of that offensive line here. You can go ahead and roll it, because watch them double team down, kick out, and then right on the outside, when you get a block from the outside receiver on a safety, the cornerback is forced to squeeze down in the run lane, and that's what gave Osmo all that grass to the sideline. But they blocked that extremely well. It's called same side split zone, Sean.
On first down, slipping out of the gate, but quickly regaining balance is Yarns as he goes high-stepping right past the defender. A foot race, and Yarns breaks the big one like he has all season. Garrett Graves, the last line of defense.
I'll tell you what, they gave Montana a dose of their own medicine with that inside zone. I'll tell you, tackling and run support is going to be an issue right there for both sets of defensive backs. But look at the speed by Yarns, though. He almost housed that. Great touchdown saving tackle for by Graves. And I think Delaware can run between the tackles a little bit more.
50 yards on the run. Now they'll take a shot toward the end zone. Some contact, no flag, as Youngblood was smothered by Ronald Jackson.
Got a late flag coming in there. I like this. Going deep. Go up top. After a big play, most defenses are licking their wounds. Not Montana per se. They're pretty good. But they still need to get their chin tested after they give up a big play. take a shot at the end zone. This is not where Delaware wanted to be. Down three scores early. Hostile environment on the road.
A slow start throwing the football for O'Connor, just 2 of 7. Negative yard, making his comeback into the starting lineup after getting injured in the first half against Villanova to close out the regular season. They lose O'Connor, and then on the next series, his replacement, Zach Marker, goes down. He's lost for the year. Team that entered these playoffs just physically beat up. Pass batted down at the line of scrimmage. Cale Edwards.
I like to call on first down, trying to get a little quick. That's called a slip screen, where you, where your H-back fakes like he's going to block. But Montana defense snuffed it out. And your defensive lineman, when you can't get the sack, your coach to put your hands up. Nice play there by Edwards.
Edwards, the redshirt junior from Coeur d'Alene. They're getting a lot of snow on Interstate 90. Back west, time to throw in the pocket. Over the middle, a flutter, and it's caught wide open. Chandler Harbin, he's to the 5. Touchdown, Delaware.
The end zone for a Delaware touchdown. 44-yard touchdown pass.
44 yards to Harbin.
That's a great call on second and long. I'm surprised Montana wasn't in more of a prevent type defense, but the throw, though, by O'Connor across the middle. It was just a dig route. 15 yards across the middle. Those linebackers didn't get enough depth. He bit on the little cheese, the little shallow cross. That's what those routes will do. But that was a great throw. And you see Delaware there with the best drive of the game so far. Long run by Yarns. Then they come back and dial him up with Harvin.
Man, Ryan Carty is coaching about as hard as you can coach. He was way out onto the field trying to get the officials' attention. Delaware trying to get this two-point conversion. Still out there. You see the intensity with Carty. This to make it a one-possession game. Townsend in motion. They bootleg right. It'll dump off to Bros, trying to struggle and fight near the goal line. And he is denied. Did not get there. And each team coming up short with the two-point conversions. O'Connor, the touchdown pass. Chandler Harbin, 44 yards. The Blue Hens needed it. They're back in this game. Down 10. Second round action continuing today. Furman victorious. They look good. The 7-seed, 26-7 over Chattanooga. A thriller in Bozeman as North Dakota State wins in overtime, 35-34. So the Bison in South Dakota, Missouri Valley Football Conference showdown next week in the quarters. Don't forget the NCAA FCS Championship coverage continues next weekend with quarterfinal coverage across ESPN networks. For more information, visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. Chandler Harbin with the touchdown reception. Great story for Harbin. He was part of the national championship team at Sam Houston State with Coach Casey Keeler. That was the year Ryan Carty was there as an assistant, and Harbin followed Carty his final year of eligibility to Delaware. Wanted a chance to win a national championship. And his Blue Hens on the road, down 10. Desperately needed throw and strike for O'Connor to Harvey.
Let's take a look at the bottom of the screen here. As you see, just a two-man route. They're playing 3-on-2 for Montana. Let's see where the breakdown happens. So you get two vertical up the field, and what happens is Harvin breaks across the middle. As you see, Ryan Tyrrell, he didn't look up the receiver. He kept his eyes on the quarterback for too long. Harvin snuck right behind him.
An offense that just could not get anything going through their first three drives, able to break the big one through the air. Montana back to work on the ground and moving the pile up to the 33-yard line goes Eli Gilman. So you look at the balance for the Grizz. Osmo, 46 yards. Harris, 36 yards. Gilman now with 16 rushing yards. Pick your poison when you defend them. McDowell trying to put the touch on a beautiful over-the-shoulder throw right into the bucket for Aaron Fox.
Yeah, that's a great touch pass there. By McDowell, he liked the matchup there. Good separation by Fox. That's the thing. If you play press coverage, if you get in the wide receiver's face, you should expect the long ball.
Beat Khalil Dawsey. Gilman bouncing it to the outside. Twisted forward, tackled by Manning. But 8 more yards for Eli Gilman. Manning the stop, and Montana has this offense cooking now.
Yeah, they're running the ball well on first down. That's the game plan. That keeps you out of negative long yardage situations, too.
Looking right, going that way, juggling and making the catch is Keelan White. Went right over the top of Harry.
Another touch pass by McDowell. Watch, see that press coverage. That time he was trying to throw it to the back shoulder. But you see how White went up over top. Caught the ball with his hands over top. Harry.
This Delaware defense reeling a little bit. Blending of running the football and throwing it. Gilman snowed under after he picks up 2 or 3 yards.
See, if you're Delaware, the reason they're not sending a lot of pressure on first down, number one, is it becomes feast or famine. And when the field starts to get a little short, 2 missed tackles and it's a touchdown. But I think they do need to bring a little bit of pressure to slow down Montana's progress on first down.
Grizzlies into the red zone for the first time. Gilman's not even touched until he hits that second and third wave. As he is very close to another first down. Looks like he'll be about a half a yard shy. First trip into the red zone tonight for Montana.
Nice job on that right side. Journey Grimswood. These guys are blocking at the point of attack. They're double teaming, neutralizing the front, and getting to the second level. And as you stated, these running backs, Gilman, Osmo, they're not even getting touched until they get 6, 7 a pop.
This crowd not happy. They're going to say a knee was down back at the 10-yard line, and now they hand it off, little end-around action, and that does not fool anyone. They tried to pop Fonce over the outside, and Herring held his ground, setting up a fourth down.
You see, you get a little end-around action, but watch Herring come off, lower the boom right there. Making a play in space, he got off a block first. Kind of saw Montana setting that play up, but they didn't fool the Blue Hens that time.
Good job by the Delaware red zone defense. This will send out Ramos for the second time tonight. He connected from 43 yards earlier. 6 of 6 on the season. This one from 30. Wind at his back. Good snap, placement down, kick on the way, and it's perfect. Montana responds with 3. Ramos with a second field goal. Grizzlies back up 13.
Last go to kickoff for Montana. Townsend and Silver are deep to receive for the Blue Hens.
Eight play, 60-yard drive for Montana. Nick Ramos connecting from 30 yards, and the Grizz leading Delaware in the snow on a Saturday night. 7th night game this year for Montana. That's a program record, and they have been good under the lights. League record 19th Big Sky Championship this year. Deep kick into the end zone for the touchback. So each quarterback has had their moments albeit brief in this first half, but let's see if that last drive gets Ryan O'Connor engaged, showing his toughness out there tonight. Last week, he could not even throw the football more than 5 yards because of his injury, but there was no way he was going to miss this game tonight. 3 of 8, 43 yards, and keep in mind, 44 of those coming on the touchdown pass, so that's how quiet the passing game has been.
Yeah, both coaches really want to run the football, but they'll mix in the pass here and there. But I think Delaware needs to maintain balance, more balance than Montana in the run pass game. I don't think they can just pound Montana all day long.
Yarns is the back. Good job defensively, blowing up the hole. Yarns gets to Nash Fouch, the violent safety coming in. Lending run support, pickup of two. You keep an eye on the clock, plenty of time, over 10 minutes to go. Any big surprises to you so far with the way these teams have approached the elements?
Not really so far. I mean, when they came out passing the ball, I thought for a second, wow, it must be scripted plays. But then I think once they got off the script, both teams figured that they need to run the ball, especially on first down.
Blitz off the edge, and they're going to take a shot deep downfield. 50-50 ball, and it's caught. Oh, what a grab by Joshua Youngblood as he took it right away from Kluswich.
That's a gutsy throw, great catch, but I think the pass protection was even more impressive. As you see, gets a little separation there. Josh Youngblood goes up over the top. That's a big play, especially when they needed one. It flips the field, give them a better opportunity.
24 yards to Youngblood. They go right back to him. Joshua Youngblood, this is his third stop. He had a huge freshman year back in 2019 at Kansas State. He returned 3 kickoffs for touchdowns. He started 3 games at wide receiver. Then he was injured the next year, only played a couple of games, decided to hit the transfer portal, spent the last 2 years at Rutgers, and now in his final stop at Delaware.
He's having a good day today, I'll tell you that. He's a matchup problem.
High snap, they go over the middle. That one had some juice behind it. Youngblood could not reel it in.
There's a lot going on that play. You get a little misdirection in the backfield with Jet. Good job by Montana playing good eye discipline. You see Youngblood's numbers on the season. That young man is a pretty good wide receiver. You know, when you start talking about Kansas State and Rutgers, you know, he's seen all levels of college football. And right now, he's a premier wide receiver at the FCS level.
I believe this is 4-down territory. They go empty set. That's Quincy Watson in motion, keeping it right up the middle as Watson just got destroyed behind the play. O'Connor trying to plow his way up to a first down. He'll be about a yard shy, maybe 2. Braxton Hill, my goodness. And 4th down for the Blue Hens. Delaware 0-for-1 tonight as that snow intensifies.
I like the call there with the quarterback keeper, a designed jet sweep read. Don't expect O'Connor to run the ball too often, but that was a good call on 3rd and short.
He'll keep it again, try to follow a lead block from Watson, and this will be really close. 2nd and 3rd effort as O'Connor kept those legs churning, and let's see where they mark it. Boy, with the snow and the field, it's tough to really get an accurate bearing, so we'll wait and see. In fact, it's going to be close enough to bring out the chains.
I like the call. I like the call because they ran almost the same play that they did before. This time they use a running back, as you see. You fake it there, but the running back becomes Watson, essentially became a lead blocker. That was a designed quarterback run. They had success on 3rd down, but I think the 2nd effort there led to the measurement because the initial hit, he didn't get it.
Stretch of the chains, and this crowd will let you know.
Make that 0-for-2 on 4th down.
The Montana defense, another 4th down stop. They lead it by 13. Montana relied on their ground game for their offense in this first half. A couple of different backs scoring. Xavier Harris with his first touch in a while. He's started it all at 27-yard scamper, and then Nick Osmo taking it to the house.
Yeah, he showed that speed in space, man, getting outside on the inside zone play. But then Ryan O'Connor comes back and delivers a strike down the pipe. Chandler Harvin, you see his touchdown run.
Ryan Carty, year two at Delaware, was the offensive coordinator at New Hampshire for 5 years, was the OC at Sam Houston as well from 2018 to 2021. He was part of that national championship run, part of the national championship team at Delaware. He was the backup quarterback the year they won it all. He kept his relationship with Casey Keeler, and now this is his show, and he's really putting his stamp on this program. He's brought in 12 coaches over the last 2 years as he gets the right personnel, the right people in their spots.
Yeah, he brought in 45 new faces and 20-plus transfers, so he's really trying to restore the glory here.
First down run. This is Osmo with it. Yeah, it's interesting. You look at Delaware this year. They had the week two loss at Penn State, and then a couple of losses late in the year to Elon, and then the key game with Villanova that might have cost them a seed in these playoffs. And that was the game where he just lost a ton of starting quarterback, the running back, one of their offensive linemen. So not just did they take a hit on the scoreboard, but physically they took a hit.
Nick Osmo once again with a carry. 2 yard gain.
Third down coming up for the Grizz after a couple of carries for Osmo.
Yeah, I think the Grizz trying to run the football on first and second down to get it in third and manageable so that they can get a first down, try to bleed some more of this clock, maintain this field position.
Tana wanting to go a little up-tempo there, but Delaware allowed to get their substitutions onto the field, so that's why we had a pause, third down and four. Grizz have been pretty good on third downs, 3 of 6. They'll try to add another down the sideline. Pass is caught in stride. Keelan White, see you later. Touchdown.
Pass protection here. I tell you what, man, this Clifton McDowell, man, he's a handsome quarterback. He throws the ball with a lot of confidence. His receivers know. Fancy footwork in the snow there from Keelan White. What a catch. Hand-eye coordination. I don't think I was going to catch that years ago in college. I'm telling you right now, there's no way. I know you wouldn't have made that catch.
Yeah, I wasn't going to jump in on that one. Even on a bright, sunny day without snow pellets bombarding you. Keelan White walked onto this program back in 2019 out of Vancouver, British Columbia. He has found a home in Missoula. They love him. All Montana here in this first half.
And welcome back to Montana, Delaware. Let's take a look at this touchdown pass right here, Sean. You see Clifton McDowell throw that football. Keelan White catches it, high points it, tap dances on the sideline. Then he has enough left in the tank to take it to the house in the snow, man. That was a great call on third down and four.
White with the touchdown reception. You see this Montana offense, what they have done. 266 yards. They have not been stopped on their last five possessions. They had the interception early, but Clifton McDowell was able to shake that off. How good and what a find has McDowell been for Coach Bobby Houck in this offense. Named the Big Sky Newcomer of the Year, the sixth Grizzly to earn it, the fourth under Houck since Coming back to Montana, and you see some of the names of Dalton Sneed, Marcus Knight, and Justin Ford as we go back to the touchdown pass.
Yeah, we'll take a look here and really focus on the bottom of your screen here. You'll see White at the bottom, but just watch his route. Now, McDowell sees the coverage. When you get a corner that squats, that safety has to get over top sooner than that. That's called half field coverage. Some people call it cover two. And that just means you're responsible for half the field. So anytime a corner rolls up, then the safety has to get over top. Great sideline call there by Montana. That's the advantage of that check with me. You see those quarterbacks checking to the sideline too, Sean.
Gives that coach one more chance to relay and communicate. Near side throw, nowhere close. Harvin was in the vicinity. Trevin Gadney, one of the top cover corners in the Big Sky, the first team all-conference selection in the neighborhood. Marcus, you look at what Delaware is facing here in a hostile environment, down 20. You know, for the Blue Hens, they were in a similar path last week, down 28-7 in the first half. The only difference, the snow, 20-plus thousand screaming here inside Grizzly Stadium. So resiliency was the word of the week for Delaware, and that's going to get amped up even more as they try to get points on this drive and just try to weather the storm, literally and figuratively, here tonight.
Yeah, well, they're going to keep fighting. Last week, they turned the ball over three times in the first half, and that got them on hold. But on the flip side, they created three turnovers in the second half, which allowed them to come back. So they're going to keep fighting. I think they should try to run the football first down, if they can get a first down, to get so they can get down, get some points, because they get the ball back coming out in the third quarter.
Montana 2 weeks ago held Montana State 1 of 10 on third down. They've been great here tonight. Over the middle, through the hands, Harbin could not bring it in. He might have spotted Jackson Lee and taken his eyes off it. Lee, the safety, had him measured.
Yeah, Montana covered that a little better this time. The linebacker's getting some depth, but I still think that pass was there. Well, alligator arms there, possibly in traffic. Very catchable ball. Wasn't the greatest pass, but he still got it there. Harvin should have came down with that ball, but I think if they were able to move the ball there, they could have possibly tried to get some points, play some defense, and cut into this lead.
High snap goes sailing over the head of Koss through the end zone for the safety. Bad to worse in a blizzard in Missoula.
Special teams, that's the second blunder there. First was a block punt, this time to get a high snap. He didn't even have a chance to catch the punt. There's the two-point conversion that Montana was trying to get earlier. You know, when it rains, it pours, and when it snows, it pours.
Tough special teams night. And the Grizz fans in complete control, 28-6. Delaware is going to have to give the football right back to this red-hot offense.
I think this is one of the toughest places to play in the country. I mean, I think right now, if you send some teams, you know, I don't care what level it is, you put them in this stadium, first week of December with this crowd and this environment, there's going to be some problems, buddy. I'm just telling you.
No doubt about it. And you look at the FCS, there's some really loud domes. You know, traditional powers, we're seeing that this year in Vermillion with South Dakota. North Dakota State, obviously, the Fargo Dome. But here in the outdoor world, and like you mentioned, Marcus, you get to December, you just don't know what the weather is going to be. Tonight, the heavy snow, and Montana loves playing here, and these fans come out and they support them, leading all of FCS this year in attendance. They had a record crowd a couple of weeks ago in the Brawl of the Wild, putting the foot on the gas in this first half. Junior Bergen picks it up on the bounce from the 23. Bergen out past the 30, runs into his own blocker at the 35-yard line. There's a flag down as well.
Well, you know, when you give up a safety, you have to punt kickoff from the 20-yard line without the tee. puts you at a disadvantage in coverage and field position.
Good starting position for Montana. That penalty will take it out to the 35-yard line. So we'll take a break. Solid first half for Clifton McDowell. Special week for all of us here at ESPN. Victory over cancer, remembering V-Week, v.org/donate. Last week, 24 teams. That's how we started. This week, 16. You take a look at the other half of the bracket. South Dakota State pitches the shutout at home, 41-0 over Mercer. They will take on a really good Villanova team peaking at the right time. UAlbany routes the Spiders, still awaiting Idaho and Southern Illinois. The Vandals inside the Kibbe Dome. You talk about home field advantage. That place can get noisy. Montana found out just how noisy earlier this year when they made the short trip.
Tell you what, that Southern Illinois team is pretty good. Knocked off Northern Illinois earlier this season.
So after some discussion, Montana will have Delaware re-kick it. They will back them up 5 yards, and with the wind howling and the snow falling, you have a man like Bergen back. No doubt Montana wanted to give him another opportunity. Nate Reed lining up his coverage unit for the second time, following the safety with the approach and kick. High end over end kick. Bergen along the near side from the 30. Makes a move 40. Spins up to the 45. Still on his feet. And is knocked out of bounds at midfield. A return of 21 yards. Montana with this defense over the last 4 weeks. Nobody in the country has been better. And you look at it and what defensive coordinator Ronnie Bradford has done. 14 points per game, third in the country. Rushing yards pretty much non-existent for the opposition. They've been really good on third down. Same story tonight, really frustrating Delaware. And then you see what this secondary has done, led by Trevin Gradney and his 5 interceptions.
Well, one thing they do is they stop the run. They don't give up very many big plays. You get off the field on third down and they will turn you over. As you see, Delaware turned the ball over 3 times last week in the first half, but this week they haven't turned it over per se, but they turned it over on downs with those fourth down conversions. So that's just like turning the football over.
So we have a delay, and we are being told that one of the side judges along the Delaware sideline is injured. So that's what's causing this delay, and happened right there in front of the Blue Hen bench. Let's take another look and try to find out as we look. Bottom left-hand corner here as the action and the momentum goes out of bounds. Oh, yeah, right there.
Right there. Tanglement going on right there, bud.
Smile on his face. He lives to fight another day. I think he'd take a snowball tonight over that type of hit.
Yeah. But you know he ended up getting plowed. I couldn't resist that one, Sean. You think about snowballs, but you come out here with the Grizz, you get plowed, man. You got to be careful on them sidelines.
And making your way through the pass today, you probably have plows on your mind, right?
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, you set yourself up, my friend.
Oh, man. I forgot about that. Oh, man. It's good to see him all right, though. Getting up, shake it off, man. Live to fight another play.
So Montana can really deliver a knockout punch if they can score here. McDowell will keep it, patiently waiting for a hole and stretching out. Shoestring tackle made. Good gain, though, of 5 yards. Alex Villas.
It's a nice job there by that offensive line, just steady.
Offside, defense, number one, 5 yard penalty. Repeat first down.
Offsides on the defense, probably line up in the neutral zone. Probably tough to get lined up and see where, exactly where the spot of the ball is, too, for a defensive player.
Yeah, we have had heavy snow really since the opening kickoff. It was all right, and then right minute or two before the start, the sky opened up. Second straight carry for McDowell, and this time Delaware sniffs it out. That was Ty Davis. He was the first one in there, along with some of his linebacking core. Very agile and athletic secondary. When you look at Davis, he's a third-team All-Coastal player this year, the junior from New Jersey. Alex Velas, KT Say, one of the true freshmen who gets a lot of reps. Davis is their leader, both he and Nick Ware, the veterans, the experience, kind of relaying that culture of Delaware football to some of these transfers and new additions, 45 in all, as you mentioned earlier tonight. Time to throw, taking a shot, looking for White. That time Delaware had him sandwiched.
That's good coverage there by Delaware. That time they didn't give up that vertical pass. They were looking, the guy was looking to hit that slot fade, very popular route. 2023 college football. Well defended that time by Delaware.
Third and seven. Here comes Delaware. McDowell is going to run away from the blitz, pick up the first down, and then some. Herring shoulders him out of bounds, and that's the versatility. When we talk to Bobby Howe, what did he bring to this offense? And it was the ability to beat you with his feet, the dual threat.
Yeah, he gets good protection here, and you have to pick your poison when you talk about defending McDowell. If you pressure him, he can throw the ball over your head. If you drop back in zone coverage, he can take off and run. Tell you what, that sideline, that same area over there, man. The cameraman almost took one shot.
It's Ruben down there showing some toughness. This is a very tight stadium. There's not a lot of space. The fans are right on top. That's what makes it so special. A little hitch pattern coming back, diving, and they're going to say incomplete. They were looking for Aaron Fonts. Well, with that camera, that big parka, you don't want to mess with Ruben. He's that extra defender.
He didn't budge either. I mean, he stood strong in there with that action coming his way.
Great job by our crew here in the elements, bringing you the action. All Montana here in this first half, 3:48, quarter number two. Really a 2-1 edge in total offense, and like we've seen from the Grizz, it's been a balanced attack. Right up the gut, untouched, clipped, and McDowell. Celebration time, Montana. McDowell for six.
I like the call here. You get a quarterback read zone, linebackers take off. There's no one left in the middle of the field. You get two backs like that, you start having guys like Harris and Osmo. You have to honor those guys. That time McDowell kept it. It's snowing so much. You see that, Sean? He had to wipe off the area so you can spot the ball for the extra point.
How about the job by this offensive line tonight? No Liam Brown at left guard. They're hoping to get him back should Montana advance next week. Cannon and Falloff jumping into the guard position. He's been Mr. Versatile up front. And they are taking a look upstairs to see if McDowell had crossed the goal line before he flipped the ball in celebration. And again, with the snow on the field, it's tough to see exactly where the goal line is. And yeah, that looks like he's clearly a step or two into the end zone.
Yeah, he's in the air, crossing the plane. It's close, though. I wondered when he ran in the first time. Called it a touchdown. It was close.
It's Montana offense as we listen in to the call from upstairs. So McDowell with the rushing touchdown, 147 through the air, 48 yards rushing, and good chunk of those yards coming on that last drive. A late addition. He arrived this summer from Central Arkansas. He has bounced around. He spent 2 years at Louisiana Lafayette, played only two games in 2 years, had a real tragic moment, and this impacted his career. He witnessed the death of Louisiana assistant coach DJ Looney, who tragically passed away of a heart attack during practice, and that was the coach who had recruited him there. And immediately, it took him a while to kind of get back dialed into football, and rightfully so when you witness something like that. Had a frustrating year in Conway, but boy, has he ever lived up to it here in Missoula. The young man from Spring, Texas, playing in the snow for the first time in his career.
Yeah, you see the touchdown pass there, reading the coverage, getting the ball to Keelan White, but this is what he also can do. Give you a little cue run off the fake to the backs. It's just a read play. He read that well. And this offensive line is doing a phenomenal job in both running the pass. 6'4", 224, and he's sneaky fast, too. Like, I mean, when he – you don't think he's really rolling when you watch him, but he's scooting and getting away, man. But for a big fella, he's got a – I think he's a complete quarterback. I think he can make the throws. I think he's smart. And then he showed that he can do it with his legs.
Talking with offensive coordinator Brent Pease yesterday, and I asked him, what stood out? When did you know that McDowell was going to be your guy? And he said, really, right when he arrived in town, all the players just really liked him. And you can relate to that. When you get somebody new coming in and to see how he was received so quickly just speaks of his character and how he has earned the respect of his teammates. And so many of these Montana players are guys who have been around the program 4, 5, even 6 years.
And then also think when you're older, like you're a senior and an older guy, you've been around, you understand what's at stake. You're not a freshman coming in trying to fit in. I think for older guys that transfer, it's kind of easier to fit in. And then the guys that have been in the program know if you're going to be a great leader or not.
You look at this Montana roster, and it is rare in today's modern era of college football what Bobby Houck has been able to do. Not only does he recruit in-state, 47 players, 12 of them right here from Missoula, but what he is able to do so well is develop the players. They want to be a part of this program. They might not play their first 2, even 3 years, or they only contribute in special teams. And you take a look at this defense, that's about three-quarters of their players who are really starting to make their first impact on that side of the football.
Yeah, I think that speaks volumes. And he's got a gate up around the state. He's got 47 players. That means if you're a pretty good player and you're not going to the FBS, then it looks like you're staying home. Nice job there in recruiting.
Marcus Yarns, 2, maybe 3 hard-fought yards over the left side. One of those Missoula natives, Ryan Tyrrell, in on the stop.
Right now, if you're Delaware, I think you should be going with some tempo, trying to end this half on a positive note. Obviously, score is very lopsided, but there's a lot of football left. And they proved it last week that they could come back, but it wasn't from 29. It was 3 scores, not 4.
Back-to-back carries for Yarn, struggling ahead for a yard or two. Ash Bouch, Tyler Flink. Yarns is going to leave. Head back over toward the Delaware sideline. Watson replaces him.
This Montana defense isn't taking their foot off the gas either. They sent a 7-man blitz on that last play. And As you see on third downs, Delaware's 0 for 5, Montana 5 for 8. That's really been the difference, is the ability to sustain drives.
And we have not even talked about the Big Sky Defensive Player of the Year at nose guard, big number 99, until now, as he flushed him. And good poise under fire by O'Connor. He had Alex Gubner coming right at him straight on, and he had the poise to throw a strike to Youngblood.
Well, you'll see right up the middle, they run a defensive line stunt. Gubner, they move him around. He lines up at nose, but every now and then he'll line up at defensive tackle, run a twist stunt. And he does all the dirty work. I mean, he's a disruptor. He's a guy that is going to take two in pass protection. You know, he allows these linebackers, Braxton Hill and those guys, to make more plays.
O'Connor on the move, throws incomplete. You know, you go back to Alex Gubner, how rare is it for an interior lineman? He might not have the most glittering statistics, but this is the respect. It was a unanimous vote from the coaches in the Big Sky giving him that nod just because of the way he can disrupt the game.
Because he does it in both the run and the pass. And he lines up, over, I mean, he makes it hard on every center that they've played. And as you see him now, he's lined up as a defensive tackle in that four-man front. He's standing up, so he moves around, and he does a lot of different things.
So athletic. He had four interceptions back in his freshman year. A little drag pattern, and Joshua Youngblood, who has been the main weapon receiving the football, will pick up 11 yards and a first down. Cotton and Walker with the tackle. Clock will stop as they move the chains. A minute 35, Delaware with all three timeouts.
I like that play call there. That was a tough run after the catch there by Youngblood. He's having a day. I mean, you just get away from the scoreboard, but you'll see. I mean, he got game tackle. They are getting hats to the football. That's a great throw, too, by O'Connor. He was trying to make something happen, but that's the one thing about Montana. They get multiple hats to the ball.
Five catches today for Youngblood, looking for Townsend downfield, and he was out of bounds. Graves trying to muscle the explosive receiver, Jordan Townsend, and a flag comes in along the near sideline.
So a couple of things to discuss, because you see a referee with his hat off means that the offensive player went out of bounds. So we're going to try to figure out, was he forced out, pass interference, or when he went out and came back in, the official down the field, the side judge, didn't see him go out of bounds. So we'll find out what they call here.
Preliminary call, interference against Montana.
See to the right of your screen there, it was a contact there, pushed him out of bounds when the ball was in the air. That's what the call came from.
Delaware trying to get some late points. Time really not a factor with the timeouts they have. Watson flanking O'Connor to his right. Montana sends a four-man rush. Throw over the middle is caught. Phil Lutz with the catch. Good mid-air adjustment by Lutz. Transfer from the Division III program, Tufts University in Boston.
Yeah, a little zone coverage there. Oh, that was a great pass by O'Connor, just being able to thread the needle. Good pass drop there that time by Tyrrell, the linebacker. He was in, he was right there, but it's a better pass than his coverage.
Late flag coming in from along the sideline, and false start, the call wipes out the throw and catch to Lutz. It's been one of those nights for Delaware where they get something positive, and then it's been a penalty or the special teams woes. They just can't find any traction here on the road. Some audio issues with our referee tonight in the building, having some issues with his microphone, so we lost our ability to listen in to him. as the snow continues to impact a lot of different parts here in Missoula tonight. Back foot throw open as Townsend has to wait for it. Comes back to it, makes the catch, stays on his feet, and Jackson Lee rips him down, but not before 28 yards to Mr. Townsend, who has been their playmaker this season.
Yeah, he's the guy. I mean, he has been a big-time receiver for them all season, but look at the confidence in Ryan O'Connor, though, every time he throws that football. He feels like he can compete.
Delaware using their first timeout, so the Blue Hens will talk it over. You know, obviously looking at a serious uphill battle here in this second quarter, but points right before the break, something positive to build on. Plus, they will get the football to start the second half as well, as they defer to start this game.
Well, I tell you what, they need a touchdown right here. You got 32 seconds left. They've been able to answer the bell with penalties and big plays. See the current drive, 6 plays, 62 yards. I think right here, you have to go into the halftime with a touchdown. Field goal's not going to help you. So you have to be thinking here about four to five plays, take a shot, manage your timeouts. But it's very imperative. I think they're going to come back to the same route that they just threw to Townsend. So you're going to see the outside receivers break in. Townsend's going to run that corner out right to the end zone.
Raiden Gross has had a quiet night at tight end. Throwing toward the end zone. Dangerous throw, and it's caught. Man, what concentration. Hauling it in is Chandler Harbin, his second touchdown catch of the night.
I tell you what, I'm going to tell you what Delaware's doing. Regardless of how this game plays out, they're showing that Montana will give up some action in that secondary. I mean, that is a great catch. Look at the concentration. I don't know if O'Connor's a riverboat gambler or he's just got that Brett Favre confidence. But that's a great catch in traffic, in the snow. And I'm just telling you, this kid right here, for a guy that didn't play last week, he's threading the needle.
He has spent the last couple of years behind Nolan Henderson, who etched his name into a number of Delaware record books. Tremendous quarterback for the Blue Hens, and now the show is Ryan O'Connor. Trying to get the two-point conversion. He will throw toward the corner of the end zone. It was Youngblood broken up. Good job that time by Cotton. And Delaware denied the two, but they get the six with the touchdown pass as you go back to this two-point conversion.
It's good defense there by Cotton.
Delaware just last week must feel like deja vu. They were down 28-7, and then it was Nick Minicucci who led the comeback. Watson able to score, and then back-to-back touchdowns to Bros, the tight end, and a 21-point deficit just like that wiped out. Alex Schmoke with what turned out to be the eventual game-winning field goal, and Delaware storms way back. They outscore Lafayette 29-6 over the last 30 minutes of the game. The defense forcing three fumbles. So if you're Delaware, you're going, well, here we go again, maybe.
Well, I tell you what, Montana's a different opponent than Lafayette. Let's say that. But at the same time, anything's possible. I mean, the weather's a lot different as well, too, but they have to stop the run. They're going to have to get it done defensively in the second half. Have to create some turnovers, create field position.
Schmoke, who had the game-winning field goal a week ago. Ryan Carty had confidence in him. He had missed some PATs earlier this year, so they have been using Nate Reed, but Carty had the feel, and his feel certainly paid off. As Bergen returns it. And now if you're Montana with this large lead, three timeouts, you don't get too cute here if you're Bobby Houck, do you?
I think you run the ball. I think you run the ball one time or you take a knee. But I don't think that with a three-score lead, you want to do anything that can turn the football over and make a mistake and give Delaware an opportunity to get that engine running and start to come back. I think you take a shot or two just to see if you can get a call or maybe a big play.
Osmo will run it wide, and he will go out of bounds, which will stop the clock. 16 seconds. So Clifton McDowell, in his FCS playoff debut, has not disappointed. 147 through the air. Touchdown run as well, 48 rushing yards. Complete control of this offense. Second and six, the ball on the 38. He will hand it off again. This is Osmo with it for a yard or two on what should be the final play of the second quarter. Three rushing touchdowns for Montana. McDowell able to dial one up to White. This defense for the Grizz imposing their will. Delaware will get the football to start the second half. We'll be back with more from Missoula after these words.
When Elsie puts on the headgear every Saturday morning, that is the moment when the day of football can start.
Could have never have dreamt that it would have become where we are today, where fans every week, that's what they wait for, to see which headgear he's going to put on.
I like Ohio State's speed and power, but I question their place kicker and their punter.
The headgear tradition started in 1996 at Ohio State. Herb Street was fairly new on the show, and Kirk's wife, Allison, had been an Ohio State cheerleader.
He thought I might have some kind of in to try to get Brutus his headgear.
They had to do some very high-level, tense negotiations.
I'm telling you, it took three or four different back and forths until finally they green-lighted Brutus.
I'll tell you one thing.
Let's just examine the Brutus head. It's a head representing a nut, a two-tone nut.
Oh. I like the Buckeyes!
So it's ridiculous looking. You can't help but laugh.
And when he sensed that that was an entertaining moment that resonated with fans across the sport, he embraced it, and it's become a beloved tradition.
Colorado in a big upset!
I remember him as a young kid watching College Game Day, and Lee Corso was on there and putting on the headgear. He is College Game Day.
I feel like I've been watching Lee Corso do that since, you know, I was in high school. The different antics he's used and mascots he's used has been pretty incredible.
Fire Wolf costume, the Purple Cow!
Cow!
To this day, I still watch and anticipate to see what he's going to do.
Go Navy! Beat Army!
Seeing him fire off the guns is pretty funny.
My favorite one, we're at Texas, and McConaughey starts wrestling the LSU Tiger head off of LC. There was a little trickle of blood.
Katy Perry was incredible. Like, she damn near broke my man's nose, taking the mask I had off of him.
I think the best one might be the outtakes.
How can you pick against that Shibu?
Thrown out some words that might needed to be edited.
My favorite memories definitely include live animals.
We got a live duck loose on the set.
He's not afraid of gamecocks. He's not afraid of alligators. He's not afraid of dogs of any kind.
That dog is beautiful.
That dog is ugly. Give me this thing here.
I think the best part is when Coach does the okey-doke, where he grabs one head, gets ready to put it on, and then he chucks it to the side and grabs the other one.
I'm going with sweet old Alabama.
Anytime I'm watching and you don't know, you know, what he's going to pick up, that's all pretty exciting.
Penn State.
Give him that hat.
Does that mean you're going to go against your first love, Brutus?
Coach Corso is a maestro of the crowd. He can take them on a ride like not many people in the history of television can.
Corso with the duck.
He's always got something ready for the people. And to see him come out as Ben Franklin was just absolutely incredible.
I found it, Penn. This is my school.
My best moment is when he picked Texas to win the national championship.
Tonight, they shocked the entire universe.
And all the other guys up there were totally against him.
I'm going with Texas Longhorns. Hook up, Texas!
And then we won. And I've praised Coach for that ever since.
There's a time with Bill Murray. We're at Death Valley at Florida State. And he comes up, Chief Osceola, and he's dancing, and he's dancing. And Bill Murray sees that, and he picked Clemson, and he picks him up.
It's a takedown.
WWE style. It's chaos everywhere.
Somebody that tried to copy that would be like, it would be silly. There's only one person who can do that, Lee Corso.
I think he's been a great ambassador for college football and has brought some great perspective, but also brought laughs and fun to a game that we have to remember is still supposed to be fun and supposed to be a game.
What he's provided to so many households, what he's provided to so many of us as coaches, he put a lot of fun in the game. I just can't thank him enough.
LC going with beef.
For Lee Corso to put on that headgear 400 times, it never gets old.
Roll Tide!
It's sincere, it's authentic, it's genuine, it embraces the fans, it embraces the tradition of what makes this sport unlike any other and what makes Lee Corso a college football broadcaster, an icon that's unlike any other who's ever been involved with this sport.
And God bless the United States of America!
The fact that I've got a chance to sit next to you all these years and watch you do your thing and just learn from you, it just taught me so much about this industry, watching you perform and the way you did it.
There he is.
Hey, the Kirk Herbstreit Show.
We love you so much. You're a piece of gold that we cherish every single week.
The snow has been falling since the kick. Heavy snow at times here at halftime. Montana in the snow in Missoula, in control over Delaware. Second all-time meeting between these two teams. And Marcus Montana able to get that ground game going. Xavier Harris with the first of three rushing touchdowns for the Grizz.
Yeah, the Nick Osmo, he ran off tackle, and then QB Keith, Clifton McDowell, wanted part of that action. A little hot dog celebration at the end. Special teams, too. They played a major factor. As you see the block punt there by Sawyer, Racanelli making a play, and then continuing with special teams. Just a snap over the head led to a safety. So far it's been really all Montana, with the exception of a few passes here or there. But this defense, though, is physical as they get in the gang tackles.
Yeah, this is a group that they do not budge, and they fight for every inch, and that certainly was the case in the first half. You take a look at the numbers. Delaware with 206 total yards. Montana putting up 315. The big differential, third down. The Grizz have really been pretty good. You see the struggles for the Blue Hens. And then Delaware with the six penalties here in the first half. Some work to do for the Fighting Blue Hens for the second straight week. Down big here at the break. But tonight in the snow, a hostile environment. The two-seed Montana in control. Second half coming up. They love their football all ages. They love the snow, and they certainly love the results here at halftime. 35-12 Montana, the number two seed, an opportunity. They might not have to leave Missoula all the way up until Frisco in the finals. Furman Purple Paladins awaiting the winner of this one. North Dakota State, South Dakota rematch in the Missouri Valley Football Conference after the Bison defeated Montana State today. An instant classic there, 35-34. Let's go to the other side now and take a look. One game in progress as the shoveling continues here in Missoula. The other half of the bracket, South Dakota State rolls 41-0. They pitch the shutout. Keep an eye on Villanova. They are peaking at the right time. They win over Youngstown State. UAlbany wins big over Richmond. And Southern Illinois, the Missouri Valley Football Conference, like they always are, really a power when it comes to the playoffs. They are winning over Idaho in the first half, 10-0. Southern Illinois. The NCAA FCS championship coverage continues next weekend with quarterfinal coverage across ESPN networks. For more information, visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. Marcus and I will be back for the start of the second half. Harvin with a couple of touchdown receptions for Delaware. Can they work some second half magic tonight here in the snow? Waldron doing some work inside our truck tonight, a Saturday night in Missoula, alongside Marcus Ray, Sean Kinney, welcoming you back to Washington-Grizzly Stadium. And for Delaware, second straight week, Marcus, the message obviously loud and clear from Hall and this defense. They need to improve, and this offense, can they find consistency in this second half?
Well, you can tell by the look on his face. He's a senior. He doesn't want to play his last game. He's not finished. He's telling his guys, rally your troops. Hey, they did it last week. They can do it again this week, regardless of the opponent. So basically, he's telling that defense, they've got to create some turnovers. You have to get Montana off the field.
Take a look at the quarterback numbers. O'Connor with a couple of touchdowns. Remember, we weren't sure if we were even going to see him tonight. He was a question mark coming in following a late season injury. But boy, he has been a gamer. The two touchdown passes to Chandler Harvin in the first half. The snow has eased up. We had some real heavy snow in the first half. More snow expected over the next couple of hours. The wind has certainly been a factor here at 3,200 plus feet. And Marcus felt firsthand just how treacherous the pass can be in the snow and the weather conditions.
That's
here,
right,
in Montana.
Got swallowed up by the Montana Grizz on the way to the game, man.
And we're two Midwestern guys, so we're used to the snow and the cold. It's those steep slopes, maybe, that we're not so accustomed to.
Yeah, it's definitely different, man. You know, speaking of O'Connor, though, he started off real slow, 2 of 7 for negative yards, or finished out that half with 132 yards, 2 touchdowns, 9 for 18. Let's see if he can keep that momentum rolling. He's been rolling the dice, threading that needle. Especially coming off that injury, couldn't even throw the ball last week.
Delaware starts up shop at the 25, and they're going to go deep right out of the gate. They were looking for Harvin, but really good coverage on the play by Corbin Walker. And there is a flag down. Maybe some contact here by Walker. Too good a coverage, apparently. We'll wait and see. These officials kept busy in the first half. Walker, the first team Big Sky selection. Too much contact, Marcus.
Yeah, he's grabbing the back of the jersey. It was slight towards the end of the play, but he really ran with about 3 good steps of jersey. And for Delaware, that's just as good as a completion. Is to take a shot. Either you're going to catch it or you might get the penalty.
Yarns, their leading rusher, with 68 yards in the first half. Youngblood leading the receivers, 5 catches, 43 yards. Harvin with the 2 touchdown grabs. This is Quincy Watson. Real nice patience as he slipped through a little crevice brought down by Alex Gubner.
That's what they need to do on first down. And actually, they lined up in four strong. They lined up in three receivers all the way outside the numbers. That was to widen out second-level players on defense and then run the ball to the weak side. Versus a good defense like Montana, that's what you have to do. You have to run the unconventional formations and keep them off their heels. Keep them on their heels and off balance.
Second down throw, getting rid of it quickly. Again, it is Youngblood with another catch, about a yard shy of the first down. Gradney the coverage.
Anytime you see a receiver going short motion, Sean, a lot of times it's to tell the quarterback if it's man coverage or not. When guys follow a motion guy, it's man. When he stays at zone, that's how O'Connor knew exactly where to go with the football on that play.
Two backs. O'Connor throws, looking for the tight end. He was involved in quite a tussle there with Trajan Cotton. Those two battling for position as the pass falls incomplete.
We haven't called his name much, Braden Bros, today, but big-time tight end. There's a lot of contact on that play, too, even with the ball in the air. Not sure how catchable it was. Coaches love that young man. Three catches last week, 39 yards, two touchdowns in the comeback, five touchdowns in the season. Big body, good athlete, he can block too.
Well, down 23, they keep the offense on the field. Big play, start this third quarter. Throw and a catch is made, a sliding grab. Joshua Youngblood again in front of Fouch and a huge fourth down conversion for the Blue Hens.
That's one way you keep defense out of your face is the sprint out, and that quick out from the inside receiver is tough to defend. It's a man beating route too. They're in man coverage, get a little rub action. I like the play calling by Delaware to start this third quarter. They're playing with a sense of urgency. They're running a diverse package to keep this Montana defense guessing.
Pistol set, Watson the running back, Townsend in motion, pressure off the edge, here comes Flink, he dodges him, and O'Connor just does a terrific job getting rid of it. He eventually got dumped on the play by Garrett Husted, but the initial pressure coming off the edge from Tyler Flink.
Took a long time for that play to develop. Good pass rush off the edge, threw off the timing there. As you mentioned, Flink, the linebacker, getting in there. So when you're a three-man front, your fourth rusher has to come from the second level. And Flink actually had a sack. He would have choked it down a little sooner.
Even though this is O'Connor's first year as a starter, this is not his first dip into the FCS playoff waters. He replaced Nolan Henderson last year against South Dakota State when he went down with an injury. So young man who has patiently waited for his opportunity to take over the keys to this offense, and he had them rolling prior to the Villanova game and the injury.
I like that call on second down, man, to really run the ball about 6.5 yards. We know it's four down territory. You don't have to get it all back at once.
Nick Minicucci into the lineup for the first time, the freshman spearheaded the second half rally last week against Lafayette. More of a running threat. We'll see if they put his legs to work here. Four receivers right. First time they've showed this formation. And now confusion and a timeout with that play clock dwindling down. Ryan Carty knows how precious this play is coming up. Some instructions for the freshman when we return to Missoula. Nick Minicucci has had to grow up in a real quick amount of time. Started the year as the fourth string quarterback, did a terrific job last week, but Ryan Carty showing him some tough love on that last situational play where they brought him out there for a third and short. Now they go back with O'Connor.
Yeah, it looked like a little miscommunication there. They had lined up in a empty formation, a diamond set with the four receivers to the left. then they didn't get the motion in time. Coach Cardi didn't like that.
And before Watson could get started, a penalty is thrown, and it looked like somebody flinched up front. Fenton Rose, the right tackle, the younger brother to the tight end, Braden.
To the right of your screen, he shifted just a little bit too. And he kind of almost got influenced. You really can't move on the D-line like that. You can shift left and right, but some Harrison there getting after Rose.
Edwards, Gubner, Harris, the three down linemen for Montana. Here they come. They send all three linebackers trying to hit Harvin out of the backfield, and it's incomplete. Just did not have enough time. Good job by Ronnie Bradford calling the blitz, setting up another fourth down.
It's unfortunate to get the penalty. It was a third and manageable. Start off with the timeout. Then it leads to a penalty. Now you're on. Get blitzed on third down. Now you have to punt when it was clearly a four-down situation. Good stop by Montana. Delaware shot themselves in the foot towards the end of that drive.
Punting has been an adventure tonight for Delaware. This time a good snap. Koss gets the punt away. Bergen with the fair catch at the 15-yard line. Legacy of championships when you look at the Grizzly program, and it is all enshrined inside the Adams Center as you take a walk down memory lane and all the different championships in all the sports, not just football, but boy, football is king in Missoula. And you go back 1897, the first football team in the history of the University of Montana. Little did they know at the time what it would grow into. And take a look at this 21st century, 198 wins. I think that gets lost. North Dakota State has all the national championships. Look at what Montana has done for so many years. Always a contender, just capturing another Big Sky championship this year, their 19th Big Sky title. Program that has a culture, a community that supports it. Usually good things happen when you have those two going in the right direction.
Yeah, and they're number two seed for a reason. They're a good football team on both sides of the ball. Got a lot of rich history and tradition. Didn't see a lot of big guys on that 1897 team like you do now, buddy, I'll tell you.
They were producing those big linemen that Eastern Montana, that half of the state, produced for several years. They have enjoyed. McDowell. Behind his right guard, setting up a third down, Jackson Taylor, another tackle for Delaware. This is the best we've seen it as far as the weather goes. Very light snow falling, complete contrast to what we witnessed in the first half.
Yeah, that snow did settle down a little bit at first. It was just all over the place.
Keep an eye on Chase McGowan. Number 12, top of the screen for Delaware. They double-team him, time the throw, and overshooting Bergen is McDowell, and a three and out for the Grizz offense.
Nice defense there by Delaware, but see the time McDowell has, and he brings that down. It's a seam route to Bergen, and he knew he missed it because he's supposed to catch that going right down the hash.
Very, very light snow now falling. Travis Benham on to punt for the first time tonight. The very dangerous Jordan Townsend awaiting the punt around midfield. Townsend took one to the house earlier this year against Hampton, 82 yards. They'll have a shot here, end over end kick, dodges one. 45 and is stood up. Flink in on the tackle, the return of 11. Good starting position for the Blue Hens. Townsend slow to get up. Delaware in a big hole here on the road. One of the unique landscapes in all of college football as we welcome you back to second round coverage of the NCAA FCS playoffs. Mount Sentinel and the patented M on the side. And our director, Eric Swornigan, ventured up there late last night. He risked grizzly bear attack and all nighttime traction to get that shot for our crew. And I see some brave souls up there tonight as well.
Yeah, we appreciate that, Eric, man. It's a good shot.
I made the journey up there early this morning.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't snowing and it wasn't dark. First and 10. This is a must get if you're Delaware. Double clutching and throwing a strike. Little button route. Townsend coming back to the ball. Lost the football. It's picked up by Jackson Lee. A scoop and score possibility. Youngblood tries to drive him down. Let's see. Touchdown, Grizz.
What a play. What an absolute play. Turn of events there.
Player down on the field.
Big time scoop and score there for Jackson Lee.
The ruling on the field is a fumble recovered by the defense and returned for a touchdown. That play is under review.
So they will take a look upstairs. Jackson Lee, after 2 years as a reserve with the scoop and score. A hustling young blood, the injured player, as he tried to make a last gasp effort to bring him down before the goal line.
Good things happen when you run to the ball. Just started off, Townsend just doing a little too much. And that looked like the ball was on his way out, though, when his side of his body hit the ground. But I'd like to finish and run to be able to hit the home run. Outrun everyone. Let's see. See if the knee was down. Ball's coming out right. Ball's coming out before the knee hits. Definitely fumbled that football, but the knee was not down. That's a good job, though, by Fouch.
See Youngblood trying to catch him, and it looked like Lee was across the goal line. Celebration for Montana. Jackson Lee grew up a Grizz fan, grew up right here in Missoula, Sentinel High School. He talked about going to all the games with his grandparents, his uncles, his granddad, a big Grizz fan. And this is another look to see if he got in. Foot stayed in bounds. Looks like this one's going to stand.
Yeah, see right here. See right there, they're checking to see if that foot, the right foot went out of bounds. But then watch the left foot come back after the right foot plants. So it looks like he stays in bounds right there. He's in bounds. Twist. Right over the pylon. That's an athletic play. That's a big time.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown. Ramos in to attempt the extra point.
The special teams has scored, the offense has scored, and now the defense with Jackson Lee finding the end zone. Lee won back-to-back state titles at eight-man Flint Creek before transferring to Sentinel High School, and what a moment for him. Here tonight in front of this large crowd, the defense with an exclamation point and a 42-12 lead.
That's called complementary football when you get it done in all three phases. Talking about offense, defense, and special teams, you never get on the board and make impactful plays. That's what makes this team really hard to beat. So they just don't have any weaknesses.
What a year it was for Montana in the Big Sky, and practically a sweep of the five major awards. They go 4-for-5. Hauk gets coach of the year. Governor for his play in the interior, defensive player of the year. Just the seventh time that an interior player in the history of the Big Sky has earned the Defensive Player of the Year. McDowell, the newcomer, Gilman, the freshman. Larison for UC Davis, the Offensive Player of the Year. You see Gubner, big number 99, this defense. Just not many weaknesses.
Not at all. I mean, their linebackers are physical, running, hitting space, defensive backs, obviously covering people, trying not to give up too many big plays.
Will drive through the end zone for the touchback. When you take a look at it, you talk about the three facets of a football game. Well, Montana, check, check, and check. The offense got it going with the ground game. Xavier Harris, the 27-yard touchdown run. And then it was Nick Osmo finding the outside using his breakaway speed. Clifton McDowell says, hey, don't forget about me, the long strike to Keelan White. So they will hit you on the ground. They'll beat you by the air. Let's factor in the special teams with the safety and the block punt. And now the defense.
And they did all of that after turning the football over. That's the only black mark that they had today, was an interception on the first possession.
Connor carrying out the fake, goes into a protective slide up to the 29-yard line. Giannacaro making sure he went down into the slide.
Ball to the 29-yard line.
Second down, near side throw, intercepted by Walker. And the roof caving in late here for the Blue Hens.
Oh, this crowd loves it. I mean, this is what home field advantage is all about, getting out there, enjoying the game. But now that, see, playmaking is contagious. You get interceptions, scooping scores, and all kind of things going on right now.
Quick throw to Junior Bergen.
Junior Bergen with
pushed out of bounds by KT Say.
Say knocks him out of bounds. 4-yard gain, second down and 6.
Delaware, 2,300 miles away from home. A big week with the announcement leaving the FCS to go FBS and join Conference USA. A lot of things to process throughout the course of the week for the Blue Hens, and here tonight on the road, taking it on the chin.
I mean, there's all kind of things going through these players' minds. You got seniors leaving. You got the good news. Was it a gift and a curse being announced right before this big game for Coach Cardi's team? And, you know, these players are thinking it's good for the guys that are coming back, obviously, or maybe some freshmen and sophomores. But there's some juniors and seniors that won't be able to cash in on some of the benefits of that move to the next level up, FBS, Conference USA. So I think it's good for the school, but you still have to play the game. I mean, I don't want to make any excuses. I still don't think that the timing of it was the best, maybe after this game. But there's a lot at, I mean, there's a lot at stake, though, you know, for this team and what they were able to accomplish this year. There's going to be some seniors next year that, when they do start to look at that move, they won't be able to play in the postseason.
Fourth down conversion. Gilman able to plow his way inside 30. Hey, you look at what this coaching staff has done this year with Delaware and Coach Cardi on the offensive side, and Benny Rojas on the defensive side. This is one of the youngest teams in the Coastal Athletic Association. They had only 25 career starts coming into this year. They lost so many to graduation a year ago, yet they reloaded and they were right there to the very end looking for a conference championship, and then they win a first-round playoff game, and then they get the tough draw to Missoula. You take a look at the last couple of years, they haven't certainly shied away in these playoffs. They go to South Dakota State. We all know the story of how that ended last year for the Jacks, and now tonight just really running into a trap with a fired-up Montana crowd playing in Montana weather.
Yes, definitely wasn't an easy draw. I mean, they're number two in this playoff bracket for a reason. Home field advantage, but this Delaware team, they reloaded that defense. I thought that was very impressive. We talked to them about that. Graduated some corners. They really tried to reload up front and then move from front to back with linebackers and getting in that portal. So I think they were able to put something together and make a nice run and did get a playoff win last week. And then a year and a half, 2 years from now, they won't be FCS.
Third win for real. All sorts of time here. Now breaking free, the tight end, Evan Schaefer, the big 280-pounder, wheeling his way to the pylon. Touchdown, Montana. Evan Schaefer finds the end zone.
There's a flag on the play. Montana.
Discussion about the flag. Evan Schaefer is a guy you do not want to see coming at you with a full head of steam, as we saw right there for the Delaware secondary. Big, big man.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Offense, number 17, his first of the game. That 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the kickoff. The touchdown is good.
So an unsportsmanlike conduct with Clifton McDowell.
Rollins attempted the extra point.
After he throws the touchdown, he paid the price getting rid of it.
But I think what they called on him is when he stood up after taking that shot, crossed his arms and stood there and let him know, yeah, that wasn't enough, but he delivered a strike. Back to Schaefer, that is 6'5", 278 in space. Man, you just can't go up there lollygagging. You either got to clip his toenails or jump on his back, because, I mean, that's just going to be a tough tackle in space for a lot of people.
And a busy night for Nico Ramos.
And you'll see right here, after taking a shot, McDowell taunting, and then he's going all the way to the sideline. Bye-bye. And here comes the flag.
Montana in the hunt for the program's third national championship. You go back to 1995. They went 13-2 that year, beat Marshall for the title. Don Reed led them. And then you push the fast forward button, 2001, a 15-1 campaign. They beat Furman, ironically, who it looks like is going to be paying a visit to Missoula next weekend. They won the FCS championship for then head coach Joe Glenn. Two championship years remembered by the faithful here in Missoula, 95 and 01. They feel they have everything in place to make a serious run at number three here in 2023.
Yeah, I was rooting for those guys in 95, man, when I was back in Ann Arbor. We were, believe it or not, man, a lot of people pay attention to FCS championship football.
It's nothing better when you look at the 24 teams, the excitement of Selection Sunday to see who's in, who's out, who earns the buys. It's really a great formula. Recently, these playoffs have been dominated by the Bison, and they are right there in the thick of it this year. Nine total championships for North Dakota State. See Georgia Southern, Appalachian State, James Madison, Marshall, all now FBS. Montana with the two titles, Eastern Kentucky.
Yeah, I was on that coaching staff at Michigan in 2007 when App State came in there and pulled off the unthinkable. So, I'll tell you what, anything's possible. You still got to play the game.
Throwback screen, and Youngblood kind of froze everybody as if he was going to throw the football, maybe thinking a double pass, and everybody froze in their tracks. And crafty little play by the veteran Joshua Youngblood.
Yeah, that was a nice little tricky little okey-doke move he put on him too. That stop and start, man. It did freeze the defense, but that's by design. That's not something he just pulled out of his back pocket. That's how you actually execute that throwback screen.
So just like that, on to the Montana side, first down. Ryan O'Connor looking left, zips it over the middle, pass batted down, incomplete. Gradney got a hand up.
Little double coverage there. Action. O'Connor was telling them to keep going, man. Run, split the double team.
Second down throw. It is Townsend with the catch. Up to the 33-yard line. Riley Wilson. We haven't talked a lot about him. Wilson, one of the few transfers that they brought in on the defensive side. Arrived from Hawaii. Came here as a safety, but they saw his size, his speed, his athleticism, and Ronnie Bradford says, you're going to be a linebacker here, and he has certainly excelled.
Yeah, closer to the ball, the better.
Well, how do you go from Honolulu to Missoula? And that's what Riley Wilson was able to do, as they set the screen up, a little middle screen action to Jordan Townsend, up to the 26-yard line, bringing up a third down. Second down.
This is really what their offense is based on, the RPOs, getting the ball to Townsend and Youngblood, mixing it up in the run with Yarns. The bros at tight end. They just haven't been able to sustain drives, and obviously this is the best team that they've played all season.
That's bros in motion, yet to make a catch today. Throw to Harbin, incomplete. Ronald Jackson in the vicinity. And the third down coming up. Connor, 15 of 29, 185 yards, the two touchdowns. He's been picked off once. Back-to-back takeaways by the Grizz defense in this third quarter. Scoop and score by Lee. Third down and three. They rush four, throw toward the side. What a catch. Wow. One-handed grab by Joshua Youngblood. Man alive, what a catch by the senior.
I mean, with all kinds of coverage on him, look at the one-hand snag. I mean, that's ESPN top 10 plays this week, man. In the snow, man. I mean, just the conditions. Tight coverage. That was a big-time grab.
Bag of tricks. O'Connor to the end zone drop. Boy, it got through. And that is one Jonathan Silver would like to have back.
I mean, he has to make this play. Now, there's contact right there. Now, is it interference? No. You got to catch the football, son. And that's a play that you can only run once. And we haven't called Silver's name all game, but that was his opportunity. Got to maintain that ball in the air, man.
Second down and 10. Second trip into the red zone tonight. Little option pitch running to the boundary side. Silver gets a couple. Cale Edwards had the initial penetration that slowed down the speed back out of Washington Township, New Jersey.
Four down territory. I tried to get
6 to 8 of it right here on some type of intermediate pass across the middle versus the linebackers.
That's exactly what they will try to do with their ground game as Silver spins his way up to the 12-yard line. Hill and Edwards the tackle.
Fourth down and four.
So if you're Delaware, you're going to expect blitz pressure. That's why they ran the football, so that they could cut it in half, put some pressure on the defense. Ball's going to have to come out quick. Are they going to go back to their sprint out pass? Or are they going to work the backside one-on-one and go for the home run?
Listen to this crowd. They are just as loud as they were in the first half. Pressure off the edge. He gets rid of it over the middle, and a gutsy catch is made in traffic. And that'll move the chains. A first down as Jordan Townsend reels it in. And O'Connor feeling the effects after he let this one go as Flink hit him.
Got rid of that ball just in time. Throwing back across his body. Another great catch in traffic.
The toughness tonight by Ryan O'Connor. He hangs in the pocket until the last possible second.
He does. And he's throwing a nice ball, too. I mean, he had the errant throw on the interception, but for the most part, since the second quarter, he's been throwing dimes.
Elijah Sessoms into the game. He's the big H-back, and he's going to pave the way for Watson over the left side.
Watson with a carry.
Forward progress will be at the 3. Offensively on this line, Blaze Sparks, Patrick Shupp, Brock Gingrich, TJ Thomas, and Fenton Bros getting the job done on that last carry. Sparks at left tackle, he had a GI tract issue last week, no food in him. He had 3 IVs during the game, leading up to the game against Lafayette, then sprained an ankle late. Playoff time, you battle through. Second and goal. O'Connor looking for his 3rd touchdown of the night, trying to find Chandler Harbin, but Jackson with him every step of the way.
It's good coverage there by Jackson. A lot of grass over there, but O'Connor overshot his man. I think he rushed that pass just a little bit. He put too much on it. I think if you can underthrow it or throw it back shoulder, the defensive back would never know because he has his back turned.
These 3rd downs have not been friendly to Delaware. 2 of 10 tonight. Youngblood in motion. They hand it off right side. Power run, and he is denied a yard shy. The Buck Buchanan Award finalist for the top defensive player in college football, Braxton Hill, not budging.
No, he wasn't fooled at all. That's his man, too, and he read that. He read the lineman. We talked about him at the top of the show. 91 tackles coming in, 2 interceptions, touchdown.
O'Connor to Watson. No, O'Connor kept it. He fooled everybody in the house, and he dances into the end zone. Boy, Montana all went toward the back. And Ryan O'Connor sneaks his way in for the touchdown.
That's how you read that play right there. He fooled everybody. Even the cameraman, too. I think he went with the back, too, as you see Watson on the fake. Anytime a defensive end or a linebacker squeezes down and the quarterback will pull that ball. That time Braxton Hill crashed down extremely too far and thought he had the ball. One man to beat.
Just the 2nd rushing touchdown this year for O'Connor. And Schmoke adds the point after. Best looking drive of the night. Orchestrated by the junior from Easton, Maryland. 14 plays, 64 yards. Short touchdown run for Ryan O'Connor.
You'll see to the right of your screen there. Let's watch your edge rusher. It's going to be Braxton Hill coming off that edge. And right there, he fakes it. It's a good read there, too. And
That's what you want. Your quarterback either by himself or one-on-one in space. That was Jackson Lee that missed that tackle. And then when you get man coverage over there too, Sean, if you run the receivers off, that's just like that's like better than blocking them. You don't want them standing there hand fighting while O'Connor's trying to find a run lane. Just run to the back of the end zone, and those guys will chase you, and it makes it a one-on-one tackle for Jackson Lee.
Coming into the season, Delaware had quite a battle for the starting quarterback job. Ryan O'Connor and Zach Marker. Marker, a really good transfer they brought in from Iowa Central Community College in Fort Dodge, Iowa. And it took about 5 weeks of all offseason camp for them finally to settle in on O'Connor. And started 9 of the 12 games. When he got injured, Marker was the guy. But tonight, Ryan O'Connor showing some toughness. Well, look at Ruben. Remember, he took that shot earlier in the game along the sideline. Our cameraman, he was not fooled. He's not shaking off any, ill effects of any type of contact he's sustained.
No, he was reading his
He was the only guy not faked out.
Yeah, he probably would have made the tackle, too, if he wouldn't have had the camera. The way he read that play.
From the 42-yard line, what will be the final play of this third quarter, Nick Osmo. And Montana will carry a commanding lead late into the night here in Missoula. The defense getting involved. Walker with an interception. O'Connor gets a late touchdown, but this night belonging to the Grizz. The NCAA FCS Championship coverage continues next weekend with quarterfinal coverage across ESPN networks. For more information, visit NCAA.com, home for all 90 NCAA championships. And you take a look at the updated brackets, just two spots yet to be determined tonight. Montana well in control of this one as we march into the fourth quarter. The Grizz 49, Delaware 19. Furman winning earlier today over Chattanooga 26-7. North Dakota State wins a thriller on the road at Montana State. It sets up a rematch with South Dakota in the Dakota Dome in Vermilion next weekend. Start this fourth quarter with a flag as they hand the ball off to Xavier Harris. Alongside Marcus Ray, Sean Kenny with you. Fourth quarter from Missoula, 2C Montana. One blemish this year back on September 23rd. They have been on a roll ever since, and Bobby Houck talked about it. They have really been playing one week at a time, knowing that they could not have another setback if they wanted to accomplish their goal of winning the Big Sky Championship. So he said, yeah, these playoffs, we've been really doing it the last couple of months.
Offense, 5-yard penalty.
Yeah, and the thing is, the seeding is important. You want to talk about winning your conference, trying to finish up as high as you can in that top eight to get first round, second round, home playoff game, if you will. But that matters. And you just want to play at a high level. I mean, they're trying to win a national title. And so you can't win national titles if you're not playing the best football.
Penalty pushes it back to the 41. McDowell throws, screen play. Osmo makes the catch. You do see the creativity that Brent Pease has brought to this offense. There was a big shakeup as far as coaches for Montana. Not new coaches coming in, but what Bobby Houck did was he took his existing coaches and they all shifted roles, if you will, and Pease takes over the offensive coordinating duties, and he has brought versatility to this offense, not only with the addition of McDowell, but finding different ways to get players involved.
Yeah, and you saw that play. That was a very unconventional way of running a middle screen to a running back. But now they're just getting stuff on tape, working on some things as they progress forward.
Deep shot down the middle, dropped by White. Manning and Vilas were out there, but a good throw by McDowell, and Keelan White could not reel it in.
You see a little play action. I like how he reset his body and threw it off his back foot. I mean, threw it right to the spot, too. I mean, it just hit Keelan right in a bad spot, right in the hands. You know what I mean? I mean, but he made that great catch earlier, too, so the one for the score. But look at the McDowell, buddy. He doesn't hide his emotions. He wears them on his sleeve.
What's impressed you most about the play of McDowell, your first look at him tonight?
Well, I think just his ability to read the coverage and know, and just to discern where to go with the football. I mean, he knows. He just haven't seen bad balls. You don't see him throwing coverage.
Travis Benham with a beauty. Special teams coverage unit downfield for Montana. Everything working tonight. Special teams unit knocking it down inside the five. Carson Rostad, the linebacker. The Montana defense coming into the playoffs simply just getting better each and every week. They have held opponents under 300 yards for four consecutive games. Going to have a tough time doing that tonight, but they've excelled in the other areas. Tough day running for Delaware. You see the third down conversions. They are able to get off the field. The one interception by Walker and Alex Gubner, the main man. Mayor of Missoula inside patrolling it. This place is going to get noisy now inside the two. We're starting shape as they work from the shadows of their own end zone. Saeed St. Floor gets his first touch of the night. How's that for pressure? The true freshman out of Bergen Catholic in New Jersey with a carry with his back against his own goal line.
Yeah, he didn't get a chance to run the ball last week. Now you give it to him. 99 to go. Just looking for some breathing room offensively, just in case you have to punt the ball. Don't be surprised if they take a shot, though, here either.
Nobody wants to sit on those metal bleachers. Too darn cold, so they stay on their feet. Goal line throw, deep shot, far sideline. Lots of contact. The official looked like he was trying to find a flag, but he does not toss one as Walker and Youngblood go at it.
Yeah, second down, I'm, you know, very high percentage that when teams are back up, they will loosen you up with a deep shot, especially on second down. Get a little bit of breathing room. If he would have kept that one in bounds, it would have been interesting to see what would have happened.
O'Connor spotted something he did not like, so he's going to burn their second timeout. Break of the action from Missoula. Ryan Carty talked with his young quarterback. Let's take a look at some of the famous alumni here from Montana. Carol O'Connor starred as Archie Bunker, the 1970s groundbreaking sitcom All in the Family. How about actor J.K. Simmons, Oscar Award winner, picked up the gold statue for the 2014 drama Whiplash. Michael Ray Richardson, the fourth pick in the 1978 NBA draft. And then could forget Doug Betters, 1983 NFL Defensive Player of the Year Award for Miami. Fun to watch. I remember my dad always enjoyed watching Doug play and the effort that he brought each and every game. Pressure comes and O'Connor just did his best to get rid of it. No time to set the feet, no room to work, and it's a three and out for the Blue Hens.
Got to be a tough cookie to not wear a shirt out here today, buddy.
Yeah. I wonder if Eric, our director, went shirtless up to the M last night to show his toughness. Think so?
I need some proof of the selfie up there with a shirt.
Cost short punt returnable at the 32. And Dak able to get to the outside. Good starting position. Well, we looked at some of the famous folks who have rolled through Montana. How about we take a look at Delaware, starting with Vic Willis, played in the National League for 13 years, beginning back in 1898. Joe Flacco, Super Bowl MVP for the Baltimore Ravens, and then Elena Deladon. Was there a more athletic player than the great Deladon? And, of course, perhaps the highest profile graduate, President number 46, Joe Biden. Folks who have made the journey across the country here tonight. Not the type of outcome they were hoping for. Missoula faithful greeting them here tonight as we have a bunch of new players out there for Montana. New quarterback is a familiar name for the Grizz, and that is Kealii Ayotte. His father was a record-setting quarterback in his days wearing the Montana colors, and now Ayotte, true freshman from Hawaii. He's been getting some reps, occasional reps, the last couple of games, and young man that Bobby Houck is certainly excited to watch develop, and he says he is the future at this position. Should look toward the next few years. Isaiah Childs, the ball carrier, and he gets wrapped up. Good open field tackle there for the Blue Hens. And Keno Arrington, speaking of NFL and speaking of famous dads, Keno's father, LeVar, the great one, the two-time All-American linebacker at Penn State.
Yeah, played against that big-time player. His father, LeVar Arrington, close to being a horse collar, but no. Horse collar almost has to be where you grab the collar from, like, directly behind him and snatch him down. But if you get a little accent around the collar on a open field tackle, they normally won't call it.
Trying to bounce off the pile is Childs.
Isaiah Childs, the ball carrier, no gain.
Childs in his third year with Montana, transferred in from Akron. He was a big reason that Ronald Jackson decided to come to Missoula. Once he saw Jackson's name pop up in the transfer portal, Isaiah Childs became a big recruiter of the talented corner. Fourth and six as they keep the offense out there. Sawyer Racanelli, the receiver, left. Drew Deck, the slot to the right. That's the direction they're looking. And Deck goes up, knocked away. Good job there by Hassan Manning Jr. This is a really good true freshman. Watching film the last couple of weeks, he's just getting better and better.
Oh, that was a good pass breakup, man. Not looking back. Being able to play the ball in the air.
Delaware offense back onto the field when we come back. Exciting time of the year continues. The NCAA FCS Championship airing all games on the ESPN networks. The quarterfinals next weekend, Friday and Saturday. Then the semifinals, and it's the center stage January 7th in Frisco on ABC. FCS Championship. That road, at least for the next couple of weeks, if Montana continues to hold serve, this is going to be a tough out for anybody who comes here. Furman next up, as they were able to pick up a win earlier today, as Nick Minicucci gets his first series. Freshman from Midland Park, New Jersey. Delaware from the 25-yard line, and good open field tackle. We were just talking about the Akron connection. There's Ronald Jackson.
Young man out of Detroit, Michigan, Belleville High School. Belleville, big-time powerhouse out there in Southeast Michigan, back-to-back state champions. Probably playing for the third in a row here pretty soon. Young man can play some football, I'll tell you what.
His best season was a couple of years ago for the Zips when he started seven games. Minicucci will roll left, and the pass is caught. Short gain as he hits Watson Ryan Tyrrell, nephew to head coach Bobby Houck, in on the tackle. Take a look at Minicucci. He thought he might be the starter. He made his first career start last week, just a disastrous first half. Three interceptions, but to his defense, a couple were tips, balls that should have been caught. He showed some maturity, did not let that rattle him. He battled back in the second half. Had a couple of touchdown passes. Tonight, a healthy Ryan O'Connor, so he's coming out of the bullpen. We're taking a look at Joshua Youngblood, who has played one whale of a game tonight. Youngblood, 9 catches, 78 yards.
A nice one-hander on the sideline, too.
That's right.
Caught the ball in traffic all day. But back to Minicucci, he just needs some more reps. He needs, you know, true freshman, you're coming in. It's your first start, playoff win, get thrown in the fire, you pull it off, didn't play as well in the first half, played better. And then if you want to see his true development, you just need game reps. And then when you look at Ryan O'Connor coming back, being named the starter this week after being injured. I thought he threw the ball pretty well. I mean, he didn't have a high completion percentage, but he did have some nice throws in there. But that Montana defense was all over him, too.
Delaware needs to get it to the 34-yard line. Minicucci looking, can take off and run if he wants to, still trying to throw. Now he's going to dart toward that sideline and pick up the first down. This is what he does. He's a very good running quarterback. Last week, 46 yards on the ground, and he'll keep the drive alive.
He looked pretty quick on that last little scramble right there, the way he scooted to that sideline. I like how he kept his eyes downfield. As a defensive back, you don't know whether to come up or stay with your guy, and he was able to get the first down.
Minicucci put up very good numbers, part of the powerhouse Don Bosco in New Jersey, 2-year starter, 2-time captain. Has those leadership qualities, and he is punished, driven into the turf by Riley Wilson.
Got a little bootleg action, per se. He gets outside the pocket, and then never see a linebacker coming up like that on the bootleg. That's called second contain. Nice job by Wilson, replacing the defensive end.
Flag thrown as well, and that's what this delay is. Something had the Montana bench really irritated. And a busy night for our Missouri Valley Football Conference crew. Yeah, you see Minicucci.
Unsportsmanlike conduct. Defense, number 8. His first of the game. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
So it was not the quarterback and the elbow, it happened away from the action. And
yeah, I don't think that was enough by Minicucci to warrant any type of penalty, but it was an extended stay on the ground over there, though, during the tackle.
Penalty will take it up to midfield. Fresh set of downs for Minicucci to work from the 50. On the far hash, he will hand the ball off. There is no room to work for St. Floor as he gets a yard or two.
I got a stat for you, Sean.
Let's hear it.
Neither team has given up a sack today. It's pretty impressive.
On a night like tonight, every offensive lineman in America appreciates that stat you just gave.
That's right.
Thank you. And that's a defender. The guy Marcus giving the O-line some love. Second down and 9. Quick throw, pass caught, tackled immediately. Hit on the play by Chase Kluswich.
That's a textbook tackle. He was able to get his head out of the way so it wouldn't be targeting, get his eyes on the football. Textbook space tackle. Gotta love seeing those.
Luswich, a good story. He played at nearby Frenchtown as a running back before transferring to Sentinel here in Missoula. Played for former Grizz Dane Oliver at Sentinel High School. Third down and five at the 45, and they will hand the ball off to St. Floor, the young freshman who they are really high on, and he moved the pile. I love how he hit that hole. There was no dancing. He knew exactly where he needed to go.
Yeah, that's a good point, Sean. I mean, he got downhill. He understood what the run lane was going to be. I really think Delaware could have ran the ball a little bit more effectively in that first half before the game got away from him. And I think if they would have been able to ball control, stay out of those penalties and a few mishaps here or there, I think they had something going in the run game.
Sideline pattern, Townsend with the catch. You know, that's a good point. Yarns ripped off the 50-yarder in the first half. You look at the offensive numbers, and very quietly, Delaware up above 320 yards, Montana sitting with 380. So what's the big difference? You know, that's not a huge differential as far as yardage go, but you look at the special teams and you look at the third down conversions, and right there are the stories, and then the takeaways as well, two of them.
You got four of 14 on third down. That's 10, almost 10 possessions versus the seven for Montana.
Second down, a lot of cushion given as Harvin toe drags the catch, and he had control. First down to the 25.
Stick Minicucci, I'm telling you, man, he's pretty good. I mean, he's playing with a lot of confidence. He knows where to go with the football. He's fleet of foot. You can tell he's a competitor, too, after that comeback last week. For a freshman to throw three interceptions, a lot of guys would have tanked it.
He called that win last week the greatest moment of his life. He was all excited. First catch of the night for Braden Bros.
That's complete to Bros. Captain
Lee, Don Bosco and their quarterbacks having a nice weekend last week. Proud program. It was funny with Nick Minicucci. He was talking to some of the local media after those three interceptions. Zach Marker, the backup quarterback who was injured, went up to him and said, "Hey, man, just relax. Have fun. Play the game." And that's what he did. Takes a shot toward the tight end, and it's knocked away. Jackson Lee, who had the scoop and score earlier tonight with the PBU, and some taunting after the play, and this will be, without a doubt, a flag against the Grizz. Just unnecessary.
Yeah, a little too much swag in the back of the end zone. See, that's what happens. When you're Jackson Lee and you're a guy that makes a play like a scoop and score, your swag meter just goes through the roof, and then now you want to pop off and tell a guy, "Hey, you know I had that scoop and score earlier, scoreboard buddy," and then they'll throw it to.
Now you don't speak on experience on that, do you, Marcus?
No.
You kind of seem pretty confident breaking that analysis down.
So he had a good pass breakup, and then he gave him that swagger dagger. See, that's the other part. When you see him reach across, just can't show a guy up like that. But the thing was, is he had already made the play. He had a good pass breakup.
A couple of unsportsmanlike penalties on this drive, and Delaware has taken it back inside the red zone, and now another stoppage. Crowd getting antsy.
They want a goal line stand.
Are there better fans in football? Large fourth quarter lead. Listen to this plus. Minicucci in trouble, just throws it up, and it is intercepted. Yeah. Holy smokes, what a grab by Ryder Meyer. How did he keep his foot in?
That was a great interception, man. Yeah, watch how he gets this foot in bounds. Watch that right foot. Oh, no. That is out of bounds. Man, good camera work there. Not sure what the line judgment we're looking at. We probably just saw the catch. He didn't see the foot. That clearly half foot is out there. Stepped on that line.
Delaware is going to keep control of this football without a doubt. In fact, Montana has already sent their defense back out onto the field.
That was an ill-advised throw, too, there by Minicucci. You have to, if you're going to throw it, go ahead and throw it.
We go back to that last play.
So right here, he's under duress. You can't just throw it up. Either you go ahead and take the sack or you throw it out of bounds, but you can't throw it where it's still in the field of play, because that was almost in real time, looked like an interception. Slow it down, you see he stepped out of bounds. So you have to take care of the football.
This will be an easy one upstairs as they take a quick look at it. The heat put on by Garrett Husted, the Nebraska transfer. Nebraska's been pretty good to Montana the last few years with a couple of offensive linemen, and then Husted, three physical players coming in from Lincoln.
Gotta like the effort, though. And then, I'm not sure if he had true possession all the time, even if he didn't step out, but you can clearly see the foot on the line. Great effort, though.
After review, the pass is incomplete. It will be second down and goal for the Niners.
Ryder Meyer, man, he's like, come on, man.
Thought he had his second interception of the year, and Ronnie Bradford, the defensive coordinator, talked about Meyer and his vision from the safety spot. Son of a football coach, his dad Les, the head football coach at Fairfield, his brother Tucker, the outside linebacker coach at North Dakota State. Here comes that crowd again, second and goal. Minicucci dumps it off to the freshman, and it goes through the hands of St. Flour incomplete.
Yeah, that ball hit St. Flour right in a bad spot in the hands. You got to look it in, catch that football. I thought Minicucci could have took off running. Looked like he had a run lane there. The young fella took his eyes off the football a little prematurely.
Gonna have to hustle here. Play clock at 10. He'll take the snap with three on the play clock. Watch out, he's sacked. That's Ryan Tyrrell. Minicucci never saw him.
Maybe I shouldn't have said nothing, man. Because now that was the first sack of the game. But see, this is where Minicucci kind of got himself in trouble earlier, is where he let the play clock run down. That's what Coach Carty was talking to him about. He didn't like it, had to burn the timeout, taking a little too long to get the play in. And right there, he didn't give his linemen a chance to get their protection under control to block Tyrrell. Nice pressure off the edge, though, by Montana.
First sack of the season for Tyrrell. Fourth down, here come the Grizz again, and they're going to get to him again. Back-to-back sacks and a goal line stop. Cooper Barnum.
Defense pinned their ears back that time and got after the young fella. Fourth and goal, man.
This crowd wanted a goal line stop. The Montana D responded to the frustration of the young freshman. As Montana defense with some takeaways tonight. Now for the first time, back-to-back sacks on the night for the Grizz.
They did a good job, too, blitzing from that second level with the linebackers. And that was a good stand. I mean, that was ball was on the 9-yard line. They were able to keep them out of the end zone, push them back with 2 sacks. That's what you want to do is work some of your blitz packages. Just get them on film going into this next round of playoffs.
First down give is to Isaiah Childs. And there is an injury. Looks like one of the Montana players down, and Jackson Taylor also down on one knee. This gives us an opportunity to talk Taylor. First team all Coastal Athletic, 36th player in Delaware history to go over 100 tackles in a season. This is his first year coming over from Division II Westchester, where he was a 2-time Division II All-American. Put up big-time numbers, and his coaches talked about him. He's one of those guys, and you remember this from your playing days, there's always that one guy on the team that you have to dial back, slow him down a little bit. He's hitting the quarterback. He's punishing the running backs. Well, that guy is Jackson Taylor. See him taking a look here at Chris Walker, and this is a concern if you're Montana. Walker, the starting left tackle.
Yeah, that's the one thing about keeping your starters in this late in the game. Situation where you pretty much have this one in the bag, and then you might lose a guy or two going into the next round. So you just got to be smart when you're rotating guys in and out of there. But back to Jackson Taylor, yeah, I played with a few guys that were like that. There's a linebacker named Ian Gold, man, out of Belleville, Michigan. Second round pick, played with the Broncos for 8 or 9 years. He was one speed. I mean, even in a walkthrough, he was volatile. You know what I mean? And that's exactly how they describe Jackson Taylor. It's just one way, go.
So we will keep an eye on Chris Walker, a 7th-year player. He had to wait to find out if the NCAA was going to grant him year number 7. He found out a few days after the regular and postseason wrapped up, and this is the last thing, if you're a Montana fan, you want to see. He has been an anchor the last couple of years at left tackle, and keep in mind they're already banged up. No Liam Brown tonight. They're hoping to get him back. They're starting left guard. Offensive line, for the most part, that stayed healthy with the exception of the left guard position. Walker, Forbes, Grimsrud, and Casey started every game at their respective positions entering tonight. Childs again, Arrington the tackle.
You know, you were saying year 7 for him, and I was just thinking, and Jack Harbaugh and I had this conversation a few years ago, Jim Harbaugh's dad, that we mutually agreed that every player should get 5 years of eligibility and no red shirt. That gives you 5 years to graduate, and then you get, you know, you can leave with possibly an undergrad and a master's, but then you can develop. Like, you can actually play instead of sitting out or only playing 4 games. Play the whole year. You get 5 years of eligibility. Freshman through the grad year.
And what would make that thought even better is if they stick with that program all 5 years anymore at that transfer portal. These coaches are saying we can't develop guys because they don't stick around if they don't play
that good
year 1 or year 2. Now, the one exception has been Montana, because this is a program that, if you look up and down their roster, they are loaded with 4th, 5th, and 6th-year guys.
I'm going to tell you who else does that, too, in the Mid-American Conference is Miami of Ohio. I think, you know, what Chuck Martin has done there. Congratulations to them on the MAC championship
today. And knocked off Toledo, and that was a Rocket team that had hopes of maybe being one of the representative for the Group of 5 in a New Year's 6 bowl game.
Well, part of the reason I brought up Miami, because my son's a freshman. He plays for Miami, so I just wanted to say congratulations
to those
guys.
Out there.
Yeah. I couldn't make the game. I had to be here with you, Sean.
Work came calling, and then some for you. You've had quite the day. You have earned your sleep tonight.
I know. But this Montana team has done it the right way when you look at recruiting, man. If you can keep your players, just imagine, like, over the last couple of years, I always ask coaches, hey, is the gap closing between, you know, FBS, FCS? Well, I don't care if it's Group of Five, Tower Five. And they really said no, because if Montana, let's say, has three guys that are just through the roof good, there's a chance that somebody may come pluck them. But I think what they've been able to do is maintain their great players like Governor and those guys. So if you can maintain a program in this era with all your guys and then not have your guys get plucked by someone else, then I think it increases your chance of winning.
Throw and catch to Townsend. A lot of fans made a long journey to cheer on the Blue Hens. Just the program's second ever trip. And there is TJ Thomas, his second year. His parents drove all the way 38 hours to get here to watch him on that offensive line. Young man who took over the starting job last week following the injury to Iwanyu. Some dedication. And that's the sad part about this year, is look at players like Thomas and Braden Bros, players who are wrapping up their collegiate career for the final time, putting on the pads, and the joy, the memories that they have had, and the joy that they have brought to the Delaware fans over their careers.
And y'all, for receiver downfield, offense, number 75, penalty is declined, second down.
And these parents, they go through the wars. There's Proud Mama, TJ Thomas's mother, and he's watching the final few moments and the appreciation I'm sure she has for TJ. This is a young man that had a real bad hip injury early in his career at Georgetown, went through hip surgery, and that scared a lot of people off. Didn't get a lot of interest after that, but Delaware was one that certainly keyed in on him. And here he is, 2 years removed from hip surgery with the support of his mother. Contributor on this offensive line.
Yeah, hopefully, big fella can move, man.
He can. Hopefully she won't call you up for advice driving home those 38 hours.
Don't.
Go the opposite way.
Yeah.
You see Marcus go west, go east, and that's good. She's going east.
Yeah, I don't travel well, man. Whoa.
Chandler Harbin has played a whale of a game as he makes the catch, and now another late flag as it stays chippy.
May have a situation where you're looking at a little targeting potentially coming from that secondary of the Grizz. That's the one thing about running that football. Start hitting guys.
Play. Personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Defense number 98, 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
When you look back at tonight, certainly there's a lot if you're Montana to smile at, but one thing I guarantee you that Bobby Houck is not smiling at is when he sees these penalties and the yards and the number of post-play penalties that they have had today.
Yeah. Hasn't been the cleanest of games for the Grizz. And we'll also talk about that turnover. We're going to talk about penalties.
Got to have that discipline. Oh, another one-handed catch. That's two of them we've seen tonight by Delaware. That's the tight end holding that one in. Job by Andrew Miklos. Inside a minute to play. So, Marcus, you start to look ahead if you're Montana. They get another home game. Will it be Friday or Saturday night? We'll find out soon enough. We do know it will be Furman who gets the taste of the cold weather next weekend.
Yeah, coming from South Carolina. Got to make that trip. It's a different ball game coming up playing in this weather.
Furman was banged up late in the regular season, but they appear to be getting healthy and convincing win earlier today. So that's going to be a good one next weekend. Quarterfinal round of the FCS playoffs. This crowd is going to come to their feet, braving the elements tonight, a night that saw heavy snowfall, especially throughout the first half. A victory for Montana and for Delaware. number of talented players and seniors playing their final game.
Definitely. They had a great year. Got a playoff win last week. And I tell you what, they just ran into a Montana team that was a little bit better today. But they need to hold their heads high, what they're doing for that program, graduating and moving on. Then some guys will be back, and then some other guys will get a chance to play in the Conference USA here pretty soon.
You look ahead for Montana. Their strengths moving forward. Is this a team that can make the run to Frisco?
I think so, definitely. If they play like this, they're going to be tough to beat, especially playing at home. That game next week's going to be good against Furman.
Brackets are set in the quarters. It's Montana and Furman, North Dakota State, South Dakota in the Missouri Valley Football Conference. For Marcus Ray, I'm Sean Kenny saying so long from Missoula, Montana. Your final score tonight, the Grizz 49, Delaware 19. All games airing on the ESPN networks are streaming live and archived on the ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN. Good night from snowy Missoula.